Welcome everybody to this third day of the Latin American Conference on High Performance Computing, the most important conference in HPC in Latin America. For me, it's a pleasure to welcome to Carla Ostoff from the Laboratorio Nacional de Cálculo Científico de Brasil. And she is the moderator and chair of this session. Please, Carla, welcome.
Thank you, Carlos. I have the pleasure, I would like to introduce Alba Mello. Alba obtained her PhD in computer science from the Institut National Polytechnique de Grenoble in France. She works at the Department of Computer Science at the University of Brasília, Brazil, where she's now a full professor and VC head of the department. She's also a CNPq Research Fellow Level 1C. Mello is a senior member of the IEEE Computer Society and the chair of the IEEE Professional Chapter, Region Brazil. From 2015 to 2019, she was member of the editorial board of the IEEE Transaction of Parallel and Distributed Systems, and she's currently member of the editorial board of the IEEE Transaction on Computers. She was a vice program chair of the IEEE International Parallel and Distributed Processing Symposium in 2019. And she is a co-general chair of the IEEE International Workshop on High Performance Computational Biology. She has served as a program committee member in many prestigious conferences such as IPDPS, Supercomputing, ICPP, ICS, Europar, CC Grid, ICC, SBAC PAD, and HIPC. So it's a really pleasure to have you here and to join us in Carla. And I hope this is a beginning of a new participation in a new community. So you're very welcome, Carla. Alba, please go ahead. Yeah.
So thank you very much for the nice introduction. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting me. And thank you all who are watching to this talk. I will share my screen. Okay, so I will talk about parallel biological sequence comparison in GPU clusters. My name is Alba Mello, and I work at the University of Brasília, Brazil. Here is the outline of my presentation. First, I will give an introduction and motivation about this work. Then I'll talk about the problem, that is biological sequence comparison. I will show you our tool for one GPU, Maza CUDA Line, and then for multiple GPUs. I will show you also some energy, one energy study, and I will show the ongoing work. We are working on multi-GPUs with pruning, and finally the conclusions. So when a biological sequence comparison is obtained, we need to establish its properties and characteristics. And this is done by comparing the new sequence with the sequences for which we already know the characteristics and the properties. If they are similar enough, we can conclude that they have the same properties and characteristics. So the biological comparison, the comparison of biological sequences, is one of the most basic and important operations in bioinformatics. The goal here is to define how similar the sequences are. There are exact algorithms that compare two sequences, and since they are exact algorithms, they produce the optimal result. These algorithms, they have quadratic time and memory complexity, so it depends on the sizes of the sequences. Heuristic methods are faster and are used in many genome projects. However, they do not guarantee the optimal result. And here we are talking about the optimal result. So Smith-Waterman proposed an algorithm that is based on dynamic programming that aligns two sequences in quadratic time and memory. And since it is exact, it produces the optimal result. But if the sequences are huge, we can have high execution time and huge memory requirements. For instance, if we want to compare the human chromosome 1 with the chimpanzee, homologous chimpanzee chromosome 1, here we're talking about 249 million of base pairs, which means millions of characters, compared to 228 million of characters. If we use the Smith-Waterman algorithm, we will compute matrices of about 60 peta elements. So I was talking about this problem, this comparison in a conference in 2008, and all the people who were there said that it was unfeasible to do that. And I will show you that in 2016, we were able to do this comparison. So the goal of the talk is to present and discuss our MASA-Q-Daline tool to compare huge chromosomes in GPUs. I will show you that we use a highly optimized algorithm to exploit the parallelism. And I will also show you that we use speculative techniques that will accelerate the sequential part of the algorithm. Concerning the results, I will show you that we were able to use up to 384 GPUs to compare the human and chimpanzee homologous chromosomes 1. I will show also some energy and power results for our tool using 4 NVIDIA Pascal and present some preliminary results with NVIDIA Volta. So I'll talk about the problem. Our problem is biological sequence comparison. In order to compare two sequences, we will place one sequence above the other and compute a score. Here you have two sequences, S0 and S1. S1 has 11 base pairs, which means 11 characters. And here at the bottom, you can see the alignment. If the characters are the same, this is a match. The value assigned for matches in this case is +1. If they are not the same, this is a mismatch. The value assigned for mismatches is -1. And we can also introduce gaps in one of the sequences. And the penalty for doing that is -2. So here you can see the alignment and the score. So this alignment that you're seeing has a score 6. But of course, we want the alignment that has the highest score. And this is done by the Smith-Waterman algorithm and its variants. This algorithm is based on dynamic programming and it has quadratic time and memory complexity. It executes in two steps. The first one is to compute the dynamic programming matrix. And at the end of the step, we will have the optimal score. Then we'll go to the next step and do the traceback. At the end of this step, we will have the alignment. So how do we compute the DP matrix? We will use the recurrence relation that I'm showing here. So it's very simple. The first term, it's a maximum operation, okay? The first term considers the gap in one of the sequences. The second term gap in the other sequence, and then we will compare the characters. If they are the same, we will use the match, otherwise the mismatch. And this is the third term, and also limited by 0. This is an example of the Smith-Waterman algorithm. We will place the first one of the sequences in the horizontal and the other one in the vertical. We will fill the first row and column with zeros. And then we will use the recurrence relation that I showed you to compute the other cells. Okay, at the end of this phase, we will compute the whole matrix and we will find the position that has the highest score that I'm showing here and where it occurs. And then step one ends. We will go to step two, retrieving the alignment, following the traceback path from the end to the beginning until we have a cell which has 0 as the value. Okay, so here you can see that it's very simple. However, imagine that we have here at the horizontal 228 million characters and at the vertical 249 million characters. So this is our problem, huge comparisons. In order to complicate a little bit, in nature, the gap, multiple gaps tend to occur together. So we use a more complicated gap model that is called the affine gap model. So in these multiple gaps, there is a higher penalty for the first gap and lower penalties for the other gaps. Gotopro to propose an algorithm to deal with this problem. And it computes three matrices instead of one. The data dependency is the same and the time space complexity is the same. But recall that the matrices can be huge. So Myers and Miller, they propose an algorithm that computes the alignment in linear space. Gotō alignments in linear space. It is based on Hirschberg's, but it implements Gotō. Let me show you the main idea of Hirschberg. He will compute the DP matrix from the beginning to the middle, only using two rows, the one that I am calculating and the other one. And then I will go to the middle. I will have the middle row and store only the middle row. Then I will compute from the end to the middle over the reverses of the sequences using the same recurrence relation. And I will stop and I will have at the end, two middle rows computed differently. So if we add the corresponding values, the corresponding positions, Hirschberg proved that the point where the addition is maximum belongs to the optimal alignment. So here you can see the cross point is the point that belongs to the optimal alignment. We will use it to split the matrix and do the same thing recursively until we find all the points that belong to the optimal alignment in linear space. Okay. But this is a HPC conference. So how do we do that in parallel? Smith-Waterman, Myers and Miller, Gotō, all of the variants have the same data dependency, which means IJ, each position IJ in the matrix depends on I minus one J, I minus one J minus one, and IJ minus one. So we cannot compute everything in parallel, of course, and we need to guarantee this. Normally, this is done by the wavefront method. So first, I can only compute this cell. Having computed the cell in blue, I can compute the cell in the cells in red and so on. So we can compute the antidiagonals of the matrix in parallel. And this is the way as waves. Okay, so this is the wavefront method. So what's very important here is that the parallelism is not uniform. It will start very slow, very low parallelism, then it will increase up to the main antidiagonal of the matrix, and then we will decrease again. Okay, now I'll show our tool, Masakuda line. So our goal, as I told you, is to compare huge DNA sequence. We will use a combination of Gotō and Myers and Miller. We have many versions of this. We have developed many versions of this tool. The first one is CUDA-Line 1.0, and we will have the similarity score. We obtain only the similarity score in one GPU. Then CUDA-Line 2.0 will compute the dynamic programming matrix, which means the similarity score, but also the traceback in one GPU. And CUDA-Line 2.1, we will compute the score and the alignment in one GPU with an optimization that is pruning. Then we went to multiple GPUs. CUDA-Line 3.0, we'll compute only the similarity score with multiple GPUs. And then we proposed a new architecture. And that's why we are calling everything Masa CUDA-Line. So The last version is Mazda-Qt Align 4.0 that will compute the score and the alignment in several GPUs. And this is mainly the thesis of my former student, Adam Sandes. This thesis was awarded the best PhD thesis in computer science in Brazil in 2016. We also received the Wilkes Award in 2019 for the best paper published in the computer journal in 2018. So let me show you how it works in one GPU. Recall that the algorithm has two steps, compute the DP matrix and traceback. Our tool has five stages. Stage one will compute step one of the algorithm, and stages 2 to 5 will compute step two, that is the traceback. In one GPU, the most compute intensive phase is stage one. So we will compute the whole dynamic programming matrices considering the row that I am computing in the previous one, but we will store some rows in disk. At the end of stage one, we will have some rows and also the position and the value of the optimal score. Then we will go to stage two. We will start from the position of the optimal score. We read the row that is closer to it. We recompute until we find the cross point. And then we read the row. So we find this point here. We read the row that's closer to it, recompute and so on, until we find the beginning of the alignment. Then we will find more points in stage three. In GPU, we will go to CPU in stage 4 and 5, finding more points. Why we go to CPU? Because it's quick, okay? We don't compensate the overhead of going to the GPU. Okay. So how do we compute the DP matrix in GPU? We divided the DP matrix in blocks, and each set of blocks will be an external diagonal. And each external diagonal will have B blocks, and each block will be computed by T threads. And the CUDA kernels will be invoked to compute the external diagonal. Here I'm showing external diagonal D4. We have in this example, 3 blocks and 3 threads inside each block. But recall the wavefront method. We have the parallelism very low at the beginning, and then it increases and decreases again. If we use rectangles, as I'm showing you here, we will have very low parallelism at some points. So we chose not to use rectangles. We will use parallelograms, okay? So, and this is a proposition of CUDA line. So this is the first invocation. We will stop at the last moment that I have the maximum parallelism. And then the next invocation for GPUs, we start here with a lot of threads. And we'll go like that up to the end. So at most of the time, we will have full parallelism with this technique. In order to do the traceback, we proposed a strategy also. Recall that the original Myers and Miller and Hirschberg, they compute row by row up to the middle, from the beginning to the middle, row by row from the end to the middle, and then compare the values, add the additions. Here, we have more information than Myers and Miller's because we have computed phase one, step one. So one of the informations that we have is that the value of the maximum addition. So we proposed orthogonal execution. This we will do the same as Myers and Miller, but from the end to the middle, we will compute column by column. And if imagine that the cross point is here. So we find and we do not compute here. So this is a proposal that we did too. When we were computing this matrix, huge matrices, we noticed that some parts of the matrix, in some parts of the matrix, the value was very slow, and it was not possible, mathematically possible, to lead to a score that higher than the score that we already have. So let me show you something here, an example. Imagine that here the value is 100, and up to the end of the matrix, I have 50 rows. So the best case is when all the characters are the same, that is a match, and the value assigned for match is 1. So if this HIJ is 100, the maximum value that I can have in the end of the matrix is 150. But the best score that I have so far is 230. So I can prune this area because it will not lead to a score that is higher than the one that I already have. This is the main idea of block pruning. We also discovered that the pruning area is defined by 2 polygons that are defined by 4 lines. And depending on the inclination of the line, we have more, we can prune more or less, okay? Okay, these are the publications for CUDA line in 1GPU. The first one was in ACM PPOP. And in this case, we compared the human and chimpanzee chromosomes 21. Here, it was 2010. I'm talking about 32 million of characters compared to 47 million of characters. We took 21 hours in 1GPU, GTX 280. And the metric that is used to compare Smith-Waterman implementations is gigacups, which means billions of cells of the dynamic programming matrix updated per second. And here we had 20.3. Okay? For CUDA line 2.0, our publication it was in IPDPS 2011. Here we have all the stages. You can see that stage 1 takes much more time than the other ones. These are seconds, okay? So we compared the same chromosomes and here obtaining the alignment, but with another GPU, GTX 285, it took 18.5 hours and our gigacups was 23.6. Okay, CUDA line 2.1, we published the IEEE transactions on parallel distributed systems. And here you can see some alignments. This is the DP matrix. What you see in gray is the area that we did not compute, but we were able to obtain the optimal result. If the alignment is small, look at C, we cannot prune a lot because the value of the score is small. But if the alignment is huge, the value of the score is huge, so we can prune more. So we compared the same chromosomes, and here we obtained using another GPU, GTX 560 Ti, in 8 hours, much better. And the gigacups is 52.85. But take a lot of time. 8 hours is a lot of time for one comparison. So we needed to go to multiple GPUs. And the first thing that we did is CUDA line 3.0. We will compute only stage 1, the DP matrix, with multiple GPUs using wavefront. So each GPU will compute a subset of columns, but they need to respect the wavefront, as I'm showing here. We also implemented I/O threads to overlap communication and computation, and we used sockets, okay? In order, for CUDA line 4.0, we had a big challenge. We needed to parallelize a stage that is sequential. Let me show you. So stage 2 starts here from the point that was obtained from in stage 1. We read the row that's closer to it and we recompute until we find this point. Then we read the row that's closer to it and we recompute until we find this point and so on. why we cannot do this and this in parallel? Because we don't know this point. This point can be here, okay? So I will recompute here. This is sequential. The other stages we can pipeline, it's no problem, but this is sequential. How we will do that in parallel? We will do speculation. Okay, so we proposed the technique that is incremental speculative traceback, and each GPU will speculate that its local maximum, it belongs to the global maximum. So here you have four GPUs. GPU 4 has the correct value, and we will start to do the traceback. This GPU is the maximum value that it has here, so it will assume that it belongs to the optimal alignment, and we will compute. And all the GPUs will do the same. When GPU finishes, it will have a point. Imagine that is this one. So we were correct. We do not need to recompute. So very good. But it can be another one. And in this case, we need to recompute. Recall that all the GPUs are speculating. So GPU 3 is speculating. Imagine that with the speculation, it found this position instead of this one. So it will send to GPU 2, and GPU 2 will do another speculation. So we can have many speculations in order to increase the probability of having the correct result. So this is the main idea. This is our design. Let me show you what happens from the point of view of GPU I. It will be idle for TI until the wavefront arrives in it. This is stage one. Then it will compute for this time in stage one, and it will stop here. Then here, stage one finishes. GPU N will start the traceback, stage two, and then send the value to GPU N minus one, so on, etc. When it reaches GPU I, it can do in pipeline stage two, three, and four. But here, TB, it was idle. Okay, and the execution time is huge. With our technique, the same thing. For stage one, it's the same thing. It will be idle for TA, and it will compute for T1. But as long as when it finishes stage one, it will start speculation. And it can do many speculations, as I told you. So here is the end. Imagine that the speculation was not good here, but here it was very good. So almost no time computing, okay? So in our design, we claim that we are able to, with speculation, if the speculation ratio is good, the success is good, we are able to finish in much more this stage. This is a real result with 384 GPUs, okay? So in this execution, it's chromosome 16. Without speculation, as we had in our design, is like that. It finishes here, the execution, with speculation. At this point, we have speculation okay, very good. Here, the speculation was not okay. And then for this case, the speculation was okay here. So we were able to reduce considerably, as you can see, the execution time in this case. The publications for multiple GPUs, first CUDA-Line 3.0. We did a study with heterogeneous GPUs for PPOP 2014. Here we had only three GPUs, and it took 6 hours and 28 minutes. And the GigaCups is 139. Then in CC Grid 2014, we had much more GPUs. So we compared the chromosome 21 with 16 GPUs in 1 hour and 20 minutes. Recall that we were in 8 hours, and the GigaCups is 488. And also here we obtained the optimal score of the human and chimpanzee chromosomes with 64 GPUs, only stage one, and 9 hours, 9.09 hours. And our gigacups here was in fact teracups, 1.7 teracups. And finally, this is the results for QDALIGN 4.0. We were able to obtain the alignments, optimal alignments of all homologous human and chimpanzee chromosomes. The best result, of course, the chromosome one, which was our target. Using 384 GPUs, we obtained the optimal alignment of chromosome 21 in a few minutes. And chromosome 5, we got the best result for gigacups. We are talking here about 180 million of characters compared to 183 million of characters. It took 53 minutes, and the best performance was 10.3 teracups. So this is our goal. What we wanted to have in 2008, we had in 2016. It took 2 hours. We used a lot of GPUs, but it's not months or weeks. So we were able to obtain it in a feasible time. And in this comparison, we computed 56.91 petacells. Okay, we observed that some laboratories here in Brazil and in other places, they did not have GPUs. So we decided to reorganize the code of QDALIGN in a platform dependent part and platform independent. And this is the MAS architecture. So the platform specific code we will do in GPUs in the device, but we will offer in the platform independent part, the statistics, the management of the stages, etc. We will offer two types of block pruning, the diagonal, that was the first one, and the generic. Two parallelization strategy, the diagonal, which is the wavefront and the data flow, and so on. So the programmer will choose the type of block pruning and parallelization strategy. And of course, he or she needs to implement the recurrence relation in the device, okay? So we have many implementations. So far, what we have is, for GPUs, we have MASA QDALIGN, the one that I'm showing you, MASA OpenCL also. For CPUs, MASA OpenMP, MASA OMS, MASA OpenCL, and MASA STARPU. And for the Xeon Phi, Intel Xeon Phi, the accelerator, MASA OpenMP. Here, I'm showing a comparison here of some of these tools. What's interesting is that the pruning area is different depending on the tool, okay? So we noticed that it was very interesting. The publication is ACM Transactions on Parallel Computing, 2016, and the code is available in GitHub. So we did a block pruning study. And in this study, you can see in the left-hand side, we considered six ways of processing the matrix, row by row, column by column, and so on. And here in this study, we have many in the paper, but this one, we are considering PM 1.0 means that the sequences are the same. PM 0.8 means that they have 80% of similarity, and so on. And in this case, no similarity at all. They are completely different. So you can see that the pruning area is different. It's the same comparison, but only the way that we process, we will have different pruning areas. The way that most of the tools do is the diagonal, the wavefront, which is very good, but it's not the best. We found a better one that we call it square. And there is another, which is not bad, not good, is the anti-square. So this, for the data flow implementations, we use the square way of processing. And the publication for the blog Pruning Story was in the Computer Journal in 2018. As I told you, we received the Wilkes Award for this paper. This is a very theoretical paper, but if you like, it's a very nice paper. Okay, we were working a lot in Smith-Waterman, but many, many people all over the world were working too. So here I'm showing the best results for each platform. For FPGAs, the best result in TeraCups is SW Riviera. It compares small sequences of 1,000 characters, obtains only the scores with 128 FPGAs, and the TeraCups is 6.02 TeraCups. The best result for CPUs is SW MVM. The sequences are really small, 100 characters. It obtains the score and the alignment with 128 CPUs. And the performance is 0.9 TeraCups. Masa CUDA-Line 4.0, the one that I showed you, is the best one for GPUs. We compare huge sequences, hundreds of millions of characters, okay? And we obtain the score and the alignment, as I showed you. We use it up to 384 GPUs, and the TeraCups is 10.3. So these are the real executions. There is another paper with a simulation. So there is a paper in 2017 and 2020, is simulation. It compares sequences huge, as CUDA-Line does, obtains only the score, and it uses a very interesting design that is processing in memory. So it's not built yet, but here you can see the theoretical result. The upper bound is 53 TeraCups. So in the simulation, they obtained 53 TeraCups. There is no device. The device was not built, okay? And of course, when they build the design, the result will be not so good. But this is interesting because it's the theoretical result. We did some studies with energy. So I was presenting CUDA-Line 4.0 in 2016 in Chile, in Temuco. And somebody in the audience was listening, and then we talked. And he said that without speculation, from the point of view of GPUI, I have a very low power activity, of course, because the GPUI is idle. But when I speculate, there is a high power activity. So the question is the energy, where is the energy better? Without speculation or with speculation? Recall that energy is power over time. So we worked together and we did this work. They had a system that measures current, voltage, and wattage. It is based on the BeagleBone Black, which is an open source hardware. And they had an axial power module. And here you can see the device that we use to measure the energy, the power, and of course the energy. We designed a demo that connects to the device, clears and set the wires and starts the counters. And at the end of the measurement, we could measure stage ones, two and three or the whole execution. The counter is stopped and written to a file and we modified Masa CUDA-Line to include this. So these are the results. The publication was BMC Bioinformatics 2018. Here you can see, this is the average power consumption, This is the average power consumption. So on average, of course, this is a speculation. With the speculation, it's higher than without speculation on the average. But the execution time, you can see here for the speculative is lower. The average power, as I told you, is higher. But what about the energy? So the energy was lower, which is energy is time over power, multiplied by power. So the energy was lower for us. So we were very happy with this result. Even with energy, from the energy point of view, the speculation is good. Let me show you what we are doing now. We have a challenge that is execute Masa CUDA line with block pruning, with multiple GPUs and block pruning. CUDA line 3.0 and 4.0, we executed multi GPUs without block pruning. And why is this a challenge? Because block pruning will start pruning, we don't know in advance. On the execution time, it will prune some parts. And this will cause a heavy load imbalance, okay? So this is very challenging for us. So what we have done so far is to share the local score, local best score. Each GPU is computing the local best score. And recall that there is communication between the neighbor GPUs. And when we communicate the border coron, we also communicate the best score. And we have a paper in 2020, was Euromicro PDP. Okay. And we were able to use NVIDIA Pascal. The Giga Cups is only with four GPUs, 680 Giga Cups. So the challenge here is to adapt the workload to a dynamic pruning scenario. We have to pause the execution, and this will cause a great overhead. So we will pause the execution only when the load balancing benefits are higher than the overhead. And we need to consider that sequences which are not very similar do not have a big pruning area. So this is what we are doing now, okay? I have some preliminary results. Without breakpoint, we will distribute like that, and we will have load imbalance. With the breakpoint, for instance, we will distribute the first half of the matrix. Then we will analyze the pruning pattern and redistribute. You can see here that GPU4 receives more columns and redistribute in order to follow the path, the pattern of pruning. So the best result for recalling that the best result in the literature for GPUs was CUDA line 4.0, 10.3 teracups with 384 NVIDIA M2090. We obtained with this approach 2.7 teracups with 8 NVIDIA Volta, which are very nice GPUs. So we estimate that we are able to beat the best results for GPUs, which is this one, with 40 NVIDIA Voltas. And here we use 384. And we estimate that we are all able to beat the best theoretical result with 256 NVIDIA Volta. So if we have this, we want to test it. Okay, let's go to the conclusion. I hope I was able to show you that biological sequence comparison algorithms that use dynamic programming can require an extraordinary amount of computing power. We know that traditional solutions are unable to produce results in reasonable time for huge comparisons. And of course, HPC solutions that use GPUs, as I showed you, are able to provide impressive performance for this application. But it's not just to put 384 GPUs. We need, as I showed you, to work on the parallel algorithm. So we did the parallelogram execution. We did the orthogonal execution. We did block pruning. We did speculation, okay? So you need to work on the algorithm. And I didn't have time here in this talk, but also advanced GPU programming, not use all the characteristics of the GPUs, but do the basics, not use a lot of ifs in order to reduce the branch divergence, to place the data in the memory hierarchy carefully, and so on. So it's a lot of work. So this work was not done just by me, of course. First, I want to thank my former PhD student, Adam Sanges, and my current PhD student, Marco Figueiredo, who is working on the multi-GPU block pruning. Also, Jorge Teodoro from Federal University of Minas Gerais in Brazil, Maria Emilia Walter from my university, Eduardo Aigode, Xavier Martorell, and Guillermo Miranda from the Barcelona Supercomputing Center, and Manuel Jaldon from the University of Malaga. These are the people who are directly involved in the results that I showed you. But other people worked in CUDA-Line, some things that I did not show. So Azedine Bukersh from University of Ottawa, Canada, Samuel Thibault from University of Bordeaux, France, Janaína Rodrigues and Célia Haria from the University of Brasília, a couple of master's students and many undergrad students. So it's a big team that we have here. I also want to thank the Barcelona Supercomputing Center for providing access to the Minotaur GPU cluster. Here we used 64 NVIDIA M2090. I also want to thank the XSEED platform in the USA for providing us access to KFS, the supercomputer KFS. There we use 384 GPUs, M2090. And also we are using bridges with the NVIDIA Volta. That is not, we are using now the bridges hosted in Pittsburgh Supercomputing Center. I want to thank the University of Malaga for the power measurement systems that I showed you with the Pascal GPUs. NVIDIA Brazil, we also have access to their platform with the Voltas. And finally, IBM USA and the University of Oregon for the NVIDIA Volta platforms too. So as I told you, our code is available on GitHub. Let me show, a lot of people have been using Maza CUDA-Line. So in Brazil, in Croatia, in France, in India, Japan, Singapore, Spain, and USA. And we are open to collaboration. So if you want to join us in this work, we will be very happy. Thank you very much. That was my talk. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Alba, for such a very nice presentation. I have some questions from the audience. The okay. first one is about if there is currently study on supporting FPGA in Maza. I would like to add a question.
Yes.
How hard is to port Maza to new architecture, new mini cores architecture, I would say, even new CUDA GPUs. So the question is about FPGA, but okay. I would say
for... And I will, okay. Yeah. So for FPGAs, we have two lines that I'm feeling. I like bridges too. Okay, we have two lines of developing for FPGAs in our group. The first one is VHDL. So we are working in Verilog VHDL, in fact, hardware description languages. And in this case is complicated, not because of Maza, but because of the language. But in my opinion, since the way to do that, the best way to do is to have a systolic array, is better to do in VHDL or HDL languages. We have another group in my group, who is using high-level systems, synthesis. And we got some results, but the results in performance were not good, okay? They were good in energy, of course, but not in performance. So far, concerning the question, it depends. If you are using high-level synthesis, I think it will be okay. How does Maza work? We divide the matrix in blocks. So The device will compute some blocks and it will receive this part here. So the row, upper row and the left column, it will compute and give to us the right column and the bottom row. That's mainly what we do. So we have this interface and so far we don't have FPGAs because of that, because first, it's difficult to have students that want to work with FPGAs, and I want somebody to do the HDL. In this case, we will have performance, okay? But we have other works, not with MASA, in high-level synthesis, which is very good for energy. So concerning the GPUs, we executed in Fermi, and in all the architectures. Now we are porting to, I didn't say, but to Ampere. Ampere is fantastic. But what we do, as we call in Brazil, oh my God, rice and bean. Okay, our programming, we will do the basics. We will not use characteristics that are specific from our board. We will do the basics. And by doing that, the porting is easier, let's say. We did to port to Volta. They changed the way of programming, the last invocation of the kernel. So we needed to do some modification. So if anybody wants to use MASA for Volta, give an email to me because I will show you the correct code, the code that takes into account this specific thing of Volta. So to port for multiple GPUs, we did not have a lot of problem because we are using the basic CUDA instructions, okay? OpenCL also, we program it. We use the CUDA code to program in OpenCL, and we did not have problems. We port, we ported to CPUs and GPUs. We tried to port the OpenCL for FPGAs, that is the question, and it was not possible. So we concluded that the compiler that compiles from OpenCL to FPGA, it will handle very simple cases, and this code is not simple. Okay, sorry, I talked too much, I know.
Okay, in the same direction, there is a question about containers. How can you integrate without changing the computational costs in containers, for example, for cloud platforms?
Okay, so I work with clouds too. The question is not containers, okay? I think containers will be okay. It will add an overhead, even containers, virtual machines. We will add more overhead, but containers also, we will add overhead. But I think the problem for clouds is the network. So we have overlapping of communication and computation because we, I don't know if it was clear, but we exchange, we have a medium communication between the neighbor GPUs or the neighbor device. So if the cloud does not guarantee that for us, the performance will not be good. So there is in Amazon, we can build a cluster, an HPC cluster. And in this case, we can have dedicated network. And in this case, I think it will be a very interesting study to port to, I don't think it will be a problem with the containers, but we need a dedicated network. Otherwise, the performance will not be good. But yes, it's a very good, but we need the, my position is that we need the network to have dedicated network. And sometimes in cloud, we don't, if we have multiple instances.
In the same direction, yes, I have one more question in the same direction. So about what do you think to perform specialized hardware for bioinformatics issues? Thinking in new architectures, follow the experiences of AI specialized hardware. So it's in the same direction of using some specific hardware for your application.
Okay. So we have developed in FPGAs, we have some proposals in FPGAs. We don't have here, I cannot have an ASIC. I don't have the technology or the colleagues that will, how can I say, allow me to do the ASIC. But in FPGAs, we did some experiments, very good. The problem with FPGA is the connection by the PCI Express, and they cannot, we cannot compute as much as the GPU for this application. So custom design, I know, I don't think that for, I think that for this application, because we have tested FPGAs also, is GPUs. We are very happy with GPUs. And for this application, I would not go for to FPGA. But some applications such as molecular dynamic for protein folding, we know that the best platform is custom, is the name is Anton. So it's an ASIC design, very powerful. And it depends, it depends on the application. For the AI in GPUs, for instance, in fact, it's not AI. It is matrix multiplication, okay? With some parts. So the tensor cores, they are doing matrix multiplications, optimized, but I cannot say that they are really optimized for AI. They are more than AI. And in this case, yes, is if we can have a generic, more generic operation, such as they did in the tensor cores, I think it's a good idea. But to have a very specific thing in ASIC is not good. You need to think about the problem and how it evolves. And if you have an ASIC, it will be, it should be good for years. And that's my position. I think it's complicated. In FPGA is better because you can have the design much quicker, but ASIC, you need to think.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Now we go for more generic question four. So there is a lag between GPU's possibilities and bioinformatic applications. And more, when we change for large scale platforms, So in your opinion, how it is possible to reduce this gap, the gap that we have?
Yes, I know, I understand. The question is, we need people to program the GPUs. That's the we are the community. We are the high performance community. So some people, they think, I have a GPU, I can use it. It's not like that. So we have to have good students and a good group programming GPUs. So my question is, we need more courses of GPUs. We need to spread more the knowledge of programming GPUs. And with that, the GPUs will be used. What I can say is that most of the tools that I'm used to, they go to GPUs. They have the GPU versions. But some versions are not that good. So sometimes the people don't use because the version is not good. But I agree. How we can bridge the gap? I think having more courses of parallel programming, because parallel programming is, I didn't tell you here, but we had deadlock problems, we had race conditions. So the basics of parallel programming and the very advanced GPU programming too. Programming for performance, let me say. We need more people working on that. That's my answer.
We have people from the audience asking you to repeat the GitHub link.
Okay, let me share the screen.
And Maza is still better. Okay.
Hmm? Ay, ay, ay. What's happening here? Oh, yeah. Sorry. I'm stuck, sorry. I will do that. Okay.
Also, they are asking if MASA is still better when we use more data. The same person.
Is more asking. Data. No, I did not understand the question. Sorry. MASA is better. So this is the link. You can do MASA and MASA Core. MASA Core you will find. Okay? You are seeing that? Yes.
Yes, yes, yes.
Sorry, okay. What was the question, Carla?
Yes, the person is asking is from the face people that is watching from the Facebook. They say, I see the paper of IPDPS and I hope to find more information about the tests to confrontate different architectures. Can you repeat GitHub link, please? And on the other hand, MASA is still better when we use more data.
Yes, so the link is here and you have the pointers for the papers. If you want to compare the architectures, the devices, CPU, GPU, etc., go to the MASA publication, you will see. And okay, so this is MASA, as I told you, MASA killed the line. Recall that if you go to MASA OpenMP in CPU, it will be good for you for small sequences. Let me tell you what is small, up to a million characters, okay? Okay. And so it depends on the device. For GPUs, what we do here when the biologists, they want to do the comparison. More than a million characters, I will go to GPU. Less, I will go to CPU. Because MASA CUDA line is not good for small sequences. And CPU is not good for longer sequences. I didn't say something, and it's very important. We are using all the cores. So if you have 24 cores, we are using 24 cores in OpenMP, but we are not using vectorization. The compiler is not able to vectorize. So one work that I would like a student to do is to do the vectorization for CPUs. And in this case, it will be better. So answer the question. For GPUs, if we want to compare the chromosome 1 is the longest one for man, okay? But it's not the longest in nature. The longest chromosome is from a small flower, 700 million characters. So we wanted to compare it, but we need a lot of GPUs. So depends on the capacity of the device. We consider the gigaflops of the device for that. I don't know if I answered, sorry.
I think so, thank you. We have lots of questions. So we have a question about the COVID situation. So people is asking if MASA use it in the analysis on research. So, and if you have any achievements for that.
Yes, so we did a study in COVID. Of course, we are comparing biological sequence, DNA. So the first thing, the virus, COVID-19 is the disease. The virus is SARS-CoV-2 and it's RNA, okay? But what we have in the public repositories are DNAs because it depends on the host. So we compared the DNA sequences of the virus with the human as a host because we can have bat, we can have pigs, etc. We compared them with MASA OpenMP because they are small. They have 30,000 characters. In our study, we compared the first one, the reference sequence is from Wuhan. It was published at the end of 2019, is the reference sequence that we call. And the other sequences were produced, and they are being produced right now. So we compared sequences from the five continents in January to the reference sequence, February and so on. So we concluded the following. There is no mutation. So far, there are no mutations. We cannot say that there is another brand of the virus because the difference in the characters, we have about 30,000 characters. Most difference is 29 characters. Okay, so the first conclusion that we have some biologists' work, is that is the same virus, okay? With some variations, which is normal. But what we noticed is that the sequence from July, they are more different than the sequence from January and February. So we think that soon we will have another brand, a real mutation of the significant, as they call, mutation of the virus. So yes, we are working in COVID, but with MASA OpenMP. If you want to work, so you go there, pick MASA OpenMP, go to NCBI. NCBI has a link for the COVID, for the sequences, and you can compare them. It's very nice. Yeah, we are doing that. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. I have one more question from the YouTube people that is watching from YouTube. So people is asking, GPU programming is complicated and more for biologists or healthcare people. And how MASA makes easy to use for the bio community GPUs?
Good. So GPU programming, I would not say it's complicated. For us in computer science, no. But for them, yes, sure. So we are now, you will see here that we don't have, visual tool. You will use, but the biologists, they are used to scripts. They are used to that. So if the biologist, he is used to scripts, we have a how-to, we have how they will program and etc. But now I have an undergrad student that is doing a web aligner, as we call, a tool in the web where the biologist or anybody can have the easier the results. We will execute in our GPUs or our CPUs and give the results for the people that want. But it's ongoing work. Okay, but we thought about that. Yeah.
Thank you. I have more questions. Okay. So there is a question from Carlos Barrios. Can you see improvements in performance with the new generations of architecture changes in NVIDIA GPU? It is the same in the coding with the improved NVIDIA?
Yes. So my opinion was always to use the same code, the basics. So when we went to Volta, we did not use, we can have asynchronous kernels, we can have a lot of things, NVLinks, etc. We are not using that. We are using the basics. What are the characteristics of the Voltas that we like a lot? First, it has a lot of cores, 5,120 cores per board, which is very good. And the memory, HBM, high bandwidth memory, is fantastic. You can, I don't know if you notice it, but our computation, we access a lot of memory. And we put some things in global memory, that is the HBM. And we got a very good performance on that. So to answer the question, I never wanted my students to use the last trick of the GPU. I wanted to use the basics. Ta? Okay, oh, sorry. Okay, so yes, we could, I could have a student to use the last things, but what we want is to have control. And with the basics, we have control. We have control of what we put in the registers, what we put in the texture memory, in the shared memory, global memory, and so on. So I don't want to program in the upper level because we need performance. Yeah. Sorry if it was not the answer you were wanting, okay. But that's it.
Okay, you mentioned that so Maza is good for small sequences in GPU and big sequences in CPUs. So the architecture makes difference in performance. So it seems that if you go to use NASA in the new DGX from NVIDIA that has the link, NVLinear link, so you can do a very fast sequencing in huge data, amount of data. Is that, make such a kind of tests?
Yes, we did. We are very happy with that. So we don't have that in Brazil. We have in Brazil in NVIDIA. So we did as the people that I'm here. So we use a DGX one in NVIDIA Brazil, and we use it DGX two in the University of Oregon. So yes, it's impressive. Let me tell you this results here. So here we used 8. It was in DGX 2, okay? 8 NVIDIA Volta, 2 nodes, each one with 4 GPUs. And here we had 2.7 teracups. Recall that we had 10.3 teracups with 384 GPUs. So it's impressive. It's impressive if you have a Volta, but it's expensive, of course. If you have the possibility of using Volta, go there. For us, we use all the cores. If I have 5,120 cores, I will use everything. And in Ampere, now it's Ampere, it's the next one, it's about a little bit less than 7,000 cores. So we are very happy. Yes, it makes a big difference. The code is the same, but we put much more blocks, much more threads, and etc. I didn't tell you, but when we go to other GPUs, we have profiling tool that does some comparisons giving us the best number of blocks and the best number of threads inside the blocks. So if you go to a GPU and you do not configure correctly, the performance will not be good too. So yes, there's a lot of parameters, sorry.
Okay, so I think you have answered all the questions. I think we had lots of questions. So in the name of the conference, I have to thank you one more time for such a nice talk. And for such a nice presentation and to so many interesting answerings for the questions from the public. I'm very happy to have you here in the name of the conference. It's an honor to have you here, and I hope you will be part of the community, Latin community more with us.
Yeah, I'm very happy. I was very happy to give this talk, and I'm happy, really happy with the questions. We are open to collaborations. We want to collaborate, and I want to participate more in Carla, of course. Yes. Thank you very much for inviting me. And thank you for watching the talk and asking the questions, such nice questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Carla. Thank you very much, Alba. It's a pleasure to meet here in this Carla Virtual. So in a few minutes, in 50 minutes, we continue for the next session with the moderator is Rafael Mayo, and it's about the Infinite Valley Network Computing Technology and Roadmap by Scott Schultz from NVIDIA. So just in 50 minutes, we continue with the regular program. Thank you very much.
can hide your head. You can throw me in the lime pit. You can blow my day and tell me I'm not blue. Everybody knows what I was sad I felt for you. Everywhere I go, I don't know where I am. Bye. the grace of God. Lord, although I'll keep my social distance, what this world needs is a hug. Until we find a vaccination, there's no substitute in love. So love yourself and love your family, love your neighbor and your friend. Anytime we love a stranger, but just a friend you ain't met yet. Yeah. Hola, para las pruebas, si queréis. No sé si me oís.
Sí, se te oye.
Vale, estupendo.
Muy bien. Scott, are you here?
Yep, hello.
Scott, okay. Can you try to share your screen, please, to see if possible to see for all audience?
It says I can't share while you're, okay. Maybe that will help. Let's see, oh, there we go.
Now maybe it's possible. Okay, nice. So in 3 minutes, I introduce Rafael and Rafael introduce you, okay?
All right.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, now we start. So thank you very much for to staying here in the next session. So let me introduce to Rafael Mayo from CIEMAT in Spain. Rafael is the session chair of this important session by NVIDIA. Welcome, Rafael.
Thank you, Carlos, and thank you all of you who are just attending this CARLA 2020 session sponsored by NVIDIA. On behalf of the program committee and the scientific committee, I am very honored of introducing Dr. Scott Scholes. He has been working, just let me translate the brief resume from him. He's high skill in technologies of high performance computing, much focused especially on the systems of artificial intelligence and machine and deep learning. Dr. Scholes has deep knowledge about system operatives, AI frameworks, high-speed networks, and processors technologies. Just before joining the Mellanox family in 2013, his responsibilities just included the performance of several engineering vacancies and direction of the different divisions and units, most related to high-performance computing, including strategic standards definition. Dr. Scott has played a key role in the development of several organizations related to industrial standards and technologies, just including the Open Fabrics Alliance or the High Performance Computing AI Advisory Council or the Open Power Foundation. So he's going to talk us about the InfiniBand Network Computing Technology, this NVIDIA sponsored presentation. So Dr. Scott, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, perfect.
All right. Yeah, so I'm Scott Schultz, Senior Director for HPC and Tactical Computing here at NVIDIA on the network business unit side. Thanks for having me. It's always a pleasure to present. So I'm just gonna start off by talking to a few examples here. So there's been 55 editions of the top 500 now, with the most recent one being released during the June digital ISC conference. And these are just a few but notable examples of HDR 200 gig installations that showcase deployments for both traditional HPC as well as AI. And even some systems here that are using a convergence of both for their scientific research. So InfiniBand already accelerates about 141 systems on the top 500. And that is now a 12% growth compared to last year's June list. And what's most interesting here is that HDR InfiniBand has really the highest adoption rate of any other generation of InfiniBand since its introduction to the top 500. So one of the key takeaways from this session is that basically, with more than 20 years of experience, as the leaders in HPC, the NVIDIA networking team continues to drive a commitment to open standards. We drive forwards and backwards compatibility and in-network computing, and advanced acceleration engines and more, and we're going to touch on a lot of that. So we really understand the solutions needed to deliver scalable performance from the latest advancements with the A100 GPUs that were just announced to the networking that delivers real-time data to them. So the DGX A100 is actually a great example. There's a lot of compute capability now available with the A100 GPU. So, you know, if you take a look at the DGX A100, now there's one ConnectX-6 HDR 200 gig Gen 4 InfiniBand adapter for every single GPU inside the box. And in fact, InfiniBand has been leading the network solutions with multiple generations of DGX since its introduction. And because, you know, DGX performance is king. So, you know, from really our ultra fast intelligent adapters and switches that support this new era of in-network computing to our most advanced integrated BlueField SmartNICs, we deliver the most comprehensive portfolio of data center building blocks now that truly unlock just exceptional performance. So this slide covers at a high level some of the fundamentals of InfiniBand. InfiniBand remains the most efficient way to actually move data. And by using the fundamental concepts of what's called RDMA, so being able to do direct data placement into user space, having absolutely no need for the CPU or the operating system's involvement. And so we're building much smarter endpoints. We're bringing more network engines closer to memory. And by bringing additional network engines and capabilities closer to memory and offloading more tasks from the compute onto the network, we now have a smarter, more capable, and more efficient network solution that can actually participate in the application's runtime. And InfiniBand is really the optimal and the ultimate software-defined network. It was actually created before the term SDN was ever even invented. And InfiniBand has huge advantages over, over any other network solution. If you just take a look at some of these slides that I'm gonna show you present, InfiniBand is I'm gonna show you that it's 3x faster over most Ethernet and other solutions. It's definitely has higher message rate, about 2x faster. It's about 2.5x more efficient when it comes to data efficiency. We have adaptive routing, we have congestion control, we support multiple network topologies, we can optimize cost performance. And so there's a number of reasons that people really standardize around InfiniBand. And in terms of comparing InfiniBand switching, let's say, to Ethernet switching, Ethernet switches are really rather expensive, and not only in just in terms of cost, but also in the complexity. So basically every Ethernet switch out there includes basically a server in every switch. They really need to deal with a considerable amount of overhead in the world of TCP. And with InfiniBand, you have a much simpler architecture. So you have the ability to add more capabilities to it. And this is just exactly what we did within network computing. And we'll cover that in just a couple of slides. InfiniBand also has a completely centralized management. So you can build any topologies, and you can optimize routing algorithms that provide additional value depending on the workload's communication patterns. And, you know, we can of course support fat trees, but also hypercubes, multi-dimensional torus. We can support Dragonfly. Each topology now has its pros and cons, but the point is, if you have an application that works well in, let's say, a torus type topology, you can really save on network costs by just reducing the amount of a number of switches. Or maybe you're going to grow your cluster over time. And so a Dragonfly Plus topology can really save a lot of money up front on the upfront cost of recabling if you know that you're going to grow your cluster. So InfiniBand today, lastly, is based on open standards. It's been accepted by the HPC developer communities to adopt it. It's also been very well accepted by the AI communities to adopt it. And they know that their engineering resources are not spinning on some one-off implementation of a network where they would need to rinse and repeat all of their optimizations and tunings across, you know, multiple generations of some proprietary interconnect. So we're going to touch on a few things, and we'll just jump right into it. But we're going to focus on SHARP and exactly what that is. We'll talk to Shield. We'll talk to a new product called UFM Cyber AI, and and so we'll just jump right into that. So we have a limited amount of time. Okay, so SHARP is an in-network aggregation mechanism, and it's developed specifically to provide this notion of in-network computing capabilities. So with the HDR quantum switch from Mellanox, SHARP V2, which is now is known, has been greatly enhanced over its previous implementation to specifically focus on deep learning workloads. And it can now handle data reductions up to 2 gigabytes in size, and we can do that at wire speed. So InfiniBand really is the ideal match for compute density, performance and flexibility with these the latest A100 GPUs. And by taking advantage of this state-of-the-art in-network, you know, computing capabilities, SHARP decreases the amount of data that's needed to traverse the network. And it actually participates in the complex communications and computations when training models. So, you know, some of the goals and the benefits of SHARP can be seen here. You know, providing very flat latency is the goal as you scale out. Now here we're showing 7x higher performance at one of the universities, the University of Toronto. And you can see that if you were to fundamentally do these all reduced type collective communications in software, as you continue to grow and you scale out, latencies just become ineffective, unproductive. And so SHARP, the goal is to maintain a very low latency. And as you continue to add more compute resources to it, and you scale out with more and more compute resources, you want to be able to show a nice up and to the right performance of your application so that they just don't fall over and top over and stop being scalable. And part of that is all about latency. And so latency as you scale out needs to remain very predictable. So very predictable latency with SHARP greatly gives, it gives you a much better scalable performance for your HPC applications. Now, if we take a look at Rocky, SHARP even has a 4x performance advantage over Rocky. And here's two examples of all reduce in terms of latency that's comparing InfiniBand with Rocky, but it also includes SHARP running with InfiniBand. And you can see here for on the left there's two charts here. So the one on the left is basically typical HPC workload message sizes on the left. And you can see the performance advantages for much larger messages on the right that are basically found in most AI workloads. And if we take a look at specifically AI, SHARP now being readily exposed when using the Nickel library or the NVIDIA Collective Communication Library. It's readily exposed through that library so that any machine learning or deep learning framework can actually leverage it. And the advantages also include reducing the communication overhead. So reducing the amount of data needed to traverse the network, and it improves latencies, which dramatically improve performance. And you can see here that we get really good performance. We get incredible performance gains up to 2.5x, which is achieved across the spectrum of the most commonly used message sizes for today's deep learning workloads. Okay, so I'm gonna spend a little bit of time talking about some of the features and capabilities and core elements of InfiniBand, one of them being congestion control. So there's basically two types of network traffic that can cause performance issues at scale. And InfiniBand has proven solutions to address each of them. And so there's in-network congestion where there is one-to-many or many-to-many communication patterns that can cause congestion. And for that, we have adaptive routing. There's a second type of congestion, which is known as in-cast congestion, where there's many-to-one communications, and that becomes the bottleneck. And InfiniBand has inherent congestion control semantics built right into the fabric. Oh, sorry, that was an animation slide. okay, so if we take a look at the Summit supercomputer, this shows one example with adaptive routing and how this affects performance. In this example, the Summit supercomputer with and without adaptive routing. The key benefit of adaptive routing is to increase the network efficiency. And at Oak Ridge, they're seeing more than 96% network efficiency used with by using adaptive routing. Now, there's another benchmark, which is called GPCNet. I know this is getting a lot of attention today. The GPCNet benchmark was created, and it's even promoted to measure, you know, congestion effects on the network and on the system. It measures the throughput and the latencies of various communication patterns. And this shows the HDR InfiniBand performance with and without congestion control. InfiniBand's congestion control mechanisms are vastly superior than other mechanisms. And this basically shows the congestion measured with the GPCNet on the HDR fabric with and without congestion control. Okay, I'm gonna talk to another feature called Shield. Shield addresses the ability to overcome network failures locally by the switches. So there are software-based solutions out there that can assist or, but software-based solutions suffer from long delays in detecting any kind of network failure. So examples of 5 to 30 seconds, sometimes for 1,000 to 10,000 K, you know, if you have 10,000 nodes, and this amount of time usually is going to result in some sort of checkpoint restart because the application is going to eventually time out waiting that long for something to recover. And Shield can actually save on these checkpoint restarts because the network can recover now from a fault, let's say from a lost link or maybe a cable failure, and we can recover almost instantly. And I'm just trying to show you some examples of this. So with Shield, if we take a look at just a standard fabric and we're trying to move data from one point up the tree through the switches and getting it to its destination, there may be a failure. And so the failure going up the tree is more of a simple fix, and Shield can automatically, let's say, detect a port failure or let's say a cable or something like that that's gone bad. And we can actually detect that failure and we can reroute the data instantaneously. And so we can safely get the data to its destination. You know, this is a fairly simple case, but there's much more difficult cases where you're trying to move the data across the fabric, and let's say you're going down the tree and getting to your destination where you are now stuck at a switch where there's no alternate route. And then for then we have what's called a fault recovery notification, and that is then broadcast back to the fabric. And so that packet has to be dropped, but then we can reroute traffic from the last known good destination and continue the data operations. And so this really is, it's a huge benefit, especially when you're training models or you're doing any kind of large data run, application run, where checkpoint restarts are going to inevitably be needed. Switching gears a little bit is around UFM, and so UFM is a very popular package for managing the InfiniBand resources, and we recently announced UFM with three tiers of capability now. including telemetry and monitoring capabilities, management and security, and added alerts for predictive and preventive maintenance have kind of all been enhanced with this called UFM Cyber AI. So UFM Cyber AI combines this real-time and historic network telemetry information with deep learning algorithms to learn a data center's operational cadence and the network workload patterns. And so this will translate into effectively enabling preventive and timely scheduled maintenance. It can detect unhealthy or unstable network ports, cables, and even provide security alerts for any kind of suspicious activity that may be going on in the fabric. One good recent example of a use case for UFM Cyber AI is, you know, during this COVID crisis, you might have read about the unauthorized use of supercomputer resources that were actually meant for COVID research. And they were actually found to be running cryptocurrency jobs. Now, so with UFM Cyber AI, this is exactly the type of traffic pattern that can be detected as an anomaly, and it'll alert the system admin and prevent, you know, these types of complications happening with the clusters. So UFM, and in particular UFM Cyber AI, is a huge value add for multi-node, you know, scale-out InfiniBand or even DGX A100 based systems. So it continues to build a rich database with real-time network telemetry information, workload usage, system configuration, and it really learns the system's normal operation. And it can really be effective to optimize InfiniBand data centers OpEx. So the the portfolio of UFM is a huge value for any data center to keep performance running at peak. And so it also has a really great interface, by the way. So it has the ability to show health reports. You can drill down into your data center's components from the inventory mapping, ensure the administrator can have instant access to not only look at the components, right down even to maybe the LinkX secure cables, but also view congestion and go and get more details and insight into the data center with the help of these AI algorithms that are built into UFM now, and alert them to any kind of off tolerance components, maybe overheating of components and the like. And UFM is actually now a part of the DGX, the NVIDIA DGX SuperPOD rollout. I'm gonna try to wrap up here. So from the left and to the right of this diagram, you have this easy picture to see how these solutions can come together. There's also a few products that I didn't cover today that complete this end-to-end solution. And for example, for customers that need to drive InfiniBand over a long distance connection, NVIDIA's Metro X can seamlessly connect InfiniBand data centers up to 40 kilometers apart. Similar to our previous generation of Metro X products, Metro X now supports HDR connectivity, and it can provide load balancing across data centers, and even continues to provide compute service with in-network computing capabilities and that type of thing in case of any unexpected data center failures. There's a lot of planning that typically goes underway when building data centers today, especially maybe like in California where earthquakes are prevalent. You know, you don't want to put all your data in one basket. So Metro X is a great solution. And of course, Ethernet will always exist. And some infrastructures and data centers insist on being able to connect to Ethernet storage or other Ethernet appliances and edge devices. And for this, we have what's known as the NVIDIA Mellanox Skyway. And this bridges the world's best fabrics on both sides from Mellanox, maintaining extremely low latencies from each side of both the InfiniBand fabric as well as the Ethernet fabric. So I'm going to try to wrap up here and take a few minutes for any kind of questions. So that's my presentation for today. I really do appreciate you guys taking the time to listen. If we'd want to open it up for questions, I'd be more than happy.
Thank you so much, Scott, for this very nice and interesting questions. Presentation. Let me check if there are any open questions. Okay, not yet. So probably people will take some time to write their questions. I will just make one meanwhile. Regarding the UFM product, have you really tested it with the Skyway NVIDIA product in order to test, let's say, monitoring of big facilities outside a data center, let's say big experiments and so on? So there could be some kind of enhancement in the monitoring of these big facilities or telemetries monitoring of different points.
Can UFM be extended across remote data centers?
Yes, I mean, if you have tested UFM with not only data centers, but big facilities, big experiments, in order to test, for example, for artificial intelligence products, in order to test if they are going to fail any kind of component from a big facility.
Ah, okay. Well, UFM continuously runs in the background, regardless of the workload. UFM uses and leverages AI built into the monitoring packages to be able to detect network failures and keep your data centers operation. So the larger that you scale, the more effective actually UFM will be. So I don't know if that answered your question, but.
Yes, they do. So I just moved to another question from Mercy and Chundia Ruiz. Which InfiniBand switch do you recommend for a cluster with 100 servers and NVIDIA DGX A100? And how is the best connection scheme to interconnect the NVIDIA DGX A100 with a traditional cluster?
Wow, okay. The latest quantum switch is the very, very best switch out there. It works very well, and it is part of the DGX SuperPod configuration. So anytime you move beyond 20 DGX A100s, InfiniBand is the de facto standard for that deployment. It's the topology is typically in a fat tree, non-blocking configuration. And the SuperPod is very much configured and pre-configured and for both fat tree as well as Dragonfly, so that it becomes very easy to add on and to extend and to expand the data center. So if you want to add another rack of systems of DGX A100 into your data center using the latest quantum switches, that is that's built into the design recipe for the DGX SuperPods.
Okay, another question from Ginés Guerrero. Many very, very interesting InfiniBand features have been mentioned. It is possible to activate some of these features in older Mellanox switches by a firmware upgrade?
So some of the firmware upgrades, some features are enhanced across, it doesn't matter if it was an EDR switch or an HDR switch, the fundamental differences in the HDR quantum switches, which I talked to today, are that Sharp has now the ability to do in-network computing within the switch itself for very, very large messages. That is not upgradable through the previous generation EDR. Sharp capabilities still exist in the EDR generation fabric, but that version of Sharp was specifically implemented to focus on small messages, which are very synonymous with CPU or traditional HPC workloads. So the message sizes that are offloaded onto the switch are much smaller in nature. But always, InfiniBand is forward, back, as well as backwards compatible. So while all of the compute features may not be able to be leveraged, let's say, between large messages or smaller messages with the previous generation, InfiniBand continues to be able to provide the functionality and the interoperability between any generation.
Okay, I would like to add a comment from Guillem Furquem to Ginés Guerrero, as he's available for talking about this issue as he works in NVIDIA Mellanox in LATAM. So I will just forward his email to Ginés for further contact. Moving to another question, this coming from Facebook Live. For federating e-learning projects, we have some challenges in communication. What is the NVIDIA answer about this challenge?
For the question is for deep learning?
E-learning, sorry.
For e-learning?
Federating e-learning projects. We have some challenges in communication. Does NVIDIA have any specific solution for this?
For both, I guess e-learning, you can certainly go to the Mellanox Academy. This still exists. So there's a lot of courses and deeper training material available on the Mellanox Academy for e-learning. If you want more information, you can certainly send me an email. And I'll get you in touch with the right, either the Deep Learning Institute on the traditional GPU side of NVIDIA, or the Mellanox Academy from the Network Business Unit side, and we can get you training for any kind of e-learning that you need.
Okay, let me check another question from Facebook Live. What about the new networks to link TPUs and GPUs?
New networks to link TPUs and GPUs. So the network, the Mellanox network, has the ability and the core capabilities to include all of the core features and capabilities, such as GPU Direct, with any other type of technology, such as an FPGA or any other device that has any amount of memory on it. You can actually do direct peer-to-peer communication completely, removing the CPU from being involved in the process. But the network fabric is not tied to the TPU or the GPU in any other, in any other way. The network fabric is still a network fabric, and all of the features of the fabric can be either developed to or used by GPUs, TPUs, FPGAs. It is really not a dependency of the accelerator that you're using. So hopefully that answers your question. If I didn't properly understand the question, go ahead and send me an email. I can provide the email address, my email address, in the chat box. So I'm very happy to answer questions. And if I can't answer them, I'll certainly get you in touch with somebody that can.
Okay, so yeah, we are moving just to the very final question, who will be answered by Guillem Figueroa to Ginés Guerrero, but let it open it right here anyway. Is there a free tool to monitor the performance of the InfiniBand network?
Yes, so the performance of the InfiniBand network, you can monitor the performance both with UFM as well as some of the built-in tools that are inherently offered as part of the switch fabric. But UFM is the most popular way, I think, today to actually monitor the performance of the fabric.
Okay. So we don't have any more questions. So I would like to deeply thank Scott for his very nice presentation, and of course for his availability for the future to open any additional question via email. So thank you so much.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for having me. I really enjoy presenting today.
So from this point on, we will move to the program for the next talk. Carlos, go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much, Rafael. Thank you very much, Scott.
Thank you.
So now, for the next session, we have to Álvaro de la Osa as president of SCALAC. Also, he is former professor of the Universidad de Costa Rica, and he is the chair of the next session. Please, Álvaro, and welcome.
Thank you very much, Carlos. It is my pleasure to introduce you today to Dr. Marcus Egger. He's currently an assistant professor in the computer science department at Cal Poly Pomona in California. And he was previously a visiting professor at the University of Costa Rica in the School of Computer Science and Informatics. Marcus leads the Sloth Lab, that's short for Symbolic Logic Operations and Transactions with Humans, where he and his students research on interactions between humans and artificial intelligence agents using video games and as an application domain. His dissertation titled Intelligent Agents for Doxastic Games laid the foundations on how to build artificial intelligent agents that can communicate effectively with human collaborators. His work has been published at leading game research conferences such as AI and Interactive Digital Entertainment, Computational Intelligence and Games, and Foundations of Digital Games. In his talk today, Dr. Egger focuses on the challenges to build cooperative artificial intelligent agents that can meet human behavior and communication. So Marcus, welcome. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, Arvavo. Let me share my slides. Okay, can you see the slides?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, thank you for the introduction and thank you so much for inviting me. I'm really excited to be here and be able to talk to all of you about my work, which might be a bit different from the kinds of works that you have seen. I've seen several talks at the conference. And what I'm doing comes from a slightly different side because it comes from the side of we have AI agents and we want them to do something useful for humans, which is not that different from what you're doing, but we need them to communicate with humans. And that poses some unique challenges. And as Arvo said, in this talk, I will talk a little bit about what we have done so far, but maybe much more about the problems and the challenges we encounter and all the things that at the present time do not have easy solutions and that are still something that we need to work on. So maybe it's a slightly pessimistic talk because it's mostly, oh, we can't do any of these things. And you might be thinking, oh, we must be fun at parties. But I think all of these are important things, important problems to handle in the future. So as Arvo said, I'm at Cal Poly Pomona. Technically, I'm only starting in January. So right now I'm an independent researcher. I'm running this Sloth Lab, which stands for Symbolic Logic Operations on Transactions with Humans. So that basically means we do work where AI agents interact with humans. They perform some sort of communication, some sort of mostly games. And most of my work historically was grounded in symbolic logic, in classical AI. Recently, I've moved more towards the machine learning side, and I will talk about why that was not possible initially and the challenges that we still encounter with that in the talk. A little bit more about myself. I'm originally from Austria, so I got a bachelor's and a master's degree from the University of Technology Graz in Austria. And then I moved to the United States to get my PhD at NC State University. And after my PhD, I was a visiting professor at the University of Costa Rica for a year and a half. And as I said, now I'm doing some independent work on natural language generation, which I'm actually also gonna briefly talk about. But basically what I want to research is how humans and AI agents can interact and how we need to build AI agents that interact better with humans in a more, let's say, human-like fashion, or at least in a fashion that's more understandable for the humans. And in my lab, we mostly use games for applications, why I would also talk about. But why is this an important problem? Well, one of the most common, I would say, human AI interactions in this modern day is things like Alexa, Siri, all of these virtual assistants, and they try to understand you. And you say like, Alexa, remind me to feed the baby. And then Alexa sends you a reminder that says, defeat the baby. Because maybe your accent is not exactly what Alexa expects. My accent, Alexa hates my accent. Maybe you, I don't know, there was background noise, maybe you mumbled, something like that happened and Alexa couldn't perfectly understand what you were saying. And I would say one of the problems there is Alexa doesn't try to reason about what you're actually trying to do, what you actually want to do. With all the knowledge that Alexa probably has about you, it could know that you have a baby and you probably do not want to defeat the baby. You probably want to give it food. So with a little bit of context, it could disambiguate these scenarios. And for these interactions, we need communication. I will talk about explicit communication a lot. There's also implicit communication. Sometimes just by observing what people do, that already tells us something of what they want to inform us about. But the explicit communication is particularly interesting because humans have very particular ways that some of them are very general, some of them are very particular to cultures. So you might know that some cultures use the hands a lot more when they talk, some cultures have very neutral expressions, and some cultures is frowned upon to smile. But these are all things that an AI could take into account when it communicates or when it tries to discern what a human is trying to tell it. And basically that's the grounding of my work. To facilitate these meaningful and productive interactions, we need to understand these communication patterns. We need to use them in the same way. And not have some AI assistant like this much beloved Clippy that just sometimes pops up for no particular reason. So what are several or some of the important aspects of human communication? Normally, when we communicate, it is goal-directed. We actually want to achieve some goal. We want to actually get to some outcome. The communication should be useful for that goal. So not only do we want to achieve something, we also want to communicate the things that are necessary and not more than necessary, not useless to the goal that we're currently trying to achieve. And of course, we also want to make our communication unambiguous. Philosopher H.P. Kreis actually wrote about this in a classic paper called Logic and Conversation. I'm going to talk a bit more about Kreis in the future. But first, in my lab, we mostly use games. Why? Well, what are games? Games can be anything. I'm not going to actually go into a definition because there's no clear definition. But you might think like video games. I mostly think board games, but anything that has rules and goals is fine. Why is that so great? Well, rules are nice because we can implement rules. They're usually written in a semi-formal way already, and then we can have a computer implementation and we have the game. And then when we have goals, we can use these goals for an evaluation. If we have chess, for example, we can say, how often does our agent win? There we have an evaluation metric. If we have Go, we can say, how often does our agent win? If we have Jeopardy, we can say, how much money does our agent make? And for these reasons and several others, AI research historically was often driven by game AI. The very first thing that people called artificial intelligence was a program that played checkers. We have this famous these famous AI agents that played chess, Deep Blue against Garry Kasparov. We had IBM Watson play Jeopardy. We had AlphaGo that played Go. We had several other games, maybe that they're becoming a bit more towards my niche, but a lot of AI research is driven by trying to get better at the game. As I said, we can test our AI techniques. We can develop them in an environment that is safe. Well, worst thing that happens is we lose the game. But the other aspect of games is many of these tasks that we're trying to achieve in games, then can they be transferred to, I hate the word, real world tasks. Why do I hate the word? Because games are a real world. It's a huge industry. So games research is important in its own right. But we can also take this and apply them to other things that are not games. IBM Watson is a famous example. Played Jeopardy, now we have like a general question answering tool based on these same technologies. Search techniques historically were developed, well, many in the context of games, some in like logistical domains, but it's always like success in the game is then applicable to something else. And historically, what people have been trying to do is they take a game and then they try to win in the game. And this is like, I call it obvious. It's not like super obvious, but it's, if you have a competitive thing, the most direct objective is to compete. But we can do other things in games. We can say like, well, apart from just optimizing the score, we want to optimize the human player's experience. And then this becomes a much more human focused problem. Maybe Deep Blue, I'm not very good at chess. I probably would not enjoy playing against Deep Blue. But there are people that develop chess AIs that basically scale to the human player's experience. That might even give hints like, oh, you just tried to do this, or you just did this. This was a bad idea. Let me explain to you what you could have done better. Of course, there's also player analytics. As I said, the games industry is huge. So there is an interest in taking the information you have about the players and learning something about them, analyzing every action that the player is doing in the game, predicting what they might do in the future, predicting what they might buy, etc. In this talk, I'll mostly focus on the optimizing the human player's experience or optimizing the win rate when the game is cooperative, which is an important consideration as well. So I'm not really gonna talk about trying to beat the human player at the game, which is an important research area, but I'm gonna talk about how can I actually work with a player. So how can I work with a player? Well, to work with a player, we need to communicate many times, usually. And how does human communication work? So this is just like a tiny introduction to communication theory. As I said, human communication uses certain patterns. Some of them are generic, some of them are used like across different cultures, some of them might be particular. But usually when people communicate, the goal is that there's mutual understanding of the topic under conversation. And of course there are exceptions. Jokes often work that way. If you know the classic comedy routine, who is on first? That's based entirely on intentional misunderstanding or misunderstanding between the communication parties that do not clarify anything. Sometimes you want to surprise someone. Well, if you prepare a surprise birthday party for someone, then you might evade questions about what are you doing this Saturday, etc. But I would say these are like exceptions. And in most situations, we actually try to cooperate by achieving this mutual understanding. And this is what Kreis calls the cooperative principle of conversation. So a little bit more about Kreis. He basically said this cooperative principle, humans follow these four maxims when they communicate. The maxim of quality basically says, what you say is true to the best of your knowledge. So you're not trying to intentionally lie to the other person. Again, there are exceptions to that. But generally in communication, if the goal is mutual understanding, you're not gonna mislead your communication partner. The maxim of quantity says that you say as much as is necessary, but not more. So you're not leaving out important things when you communicate, but you're also not gonna add unnecessary blemish just for the sake of providing information. If someone asks you, if you're a clerk, and someone asks you the price of a package of milk, you're not going to tell them the price of rice, the price of bread, the price of all of these other things if they only want to know the price of milk. The maxim of relation is related to this previous concept. It says you're only going to talk about things that are relevant to the topic under discussion. Again, like if someone asks you the price of milk, you're not going to start talking about the soccer game from last night. You're not going to talk about, sky has its particular color, etc. That is completely irrelevant to this topic under consideration. And finally, the maxim of manner. basically talks about how we communicate, particularly that we try to be unambiguous. If someone asks you the price of milk, you're not going to say like it's 7 or 17 or 5. Pick one of them. This is ambiguous. Or you're not going to like circumscribe it in some weird way that is not directly understandable by the communication partner. And by and large, in these cooperative communication scenarios, humans follow these maxims. So if you want to build an AI agent that communicates with humans, it would be useful if that AI agent follows similar rules. If it actually knew about, oh, I should not talk more than necessary. Oh, I should not lie to the other person. I should only talk about things that are relevant. I should only talk in ways that the other person can understand. So how does this actually work? Well, I said that we want to talk about the topic under consideration. And this introduces a different concept. Like, what is the topic under consideration? Usually there is a goal, and I'm not just talking about the goal of mutual understanding. This mutual understanding is in service of something that the humans that are communicating are trying to achieve. So basically we come up with a goal. Well, maybe my goal is I want to buy milk. So I form this goal in my head, and then I ask the clerk, how much is the milk? And the clerk tells me the milk is so much, because that leads me closer to my goal of buying the milk. Maybe I need to check if I have enough money on my person. And basically the idea is we have this goal, and by this using this communication act, we're trying to communicate our goal to the other person. And the other person will use what we told them to discern what we might be trying to achieve. One example that's often brought up is if I'm in a room with someone and they're sitting by the window and I say, oh, it's hot in here, they will try to discern why would I say that? I'm not just going to say that to make like casual conversation, probably. I probably have a goal. And my goal is to cool down. Like, it is hot in here. You're sitting by the window. Oh, you could open the window to make the room cool down a bit. So there's a lot of reasoning that goes on beyond communication. Like, what is this communication actually trying to achieve that humans perform during all of this interactions? So how do we actually make an AI agent with this? This is all very fun and interesting, I hope. But how does that help an AI agent? So to develop AI agents that use these concepts, we looked at, in my research, I looked at a game called Hanabi. And Hanabi is a great game because it is cooperative. So you have cards, people have cards in the hand that they cannot see themselves. So every player holds the cards facing away from them. And the game tells you how you can communicate. It has explicit rules of communication. And the goal of the players is to collaborate, to cooperatively play the cards in the 5 colors in ascending order in each color. So basically starting with the red one or the blue one or the green one, followed by the 2 in the respective color and so on. And the game basically says the only things you can tell the other people is these are all your cards of one color, or these are all your cards of one rank. So these are all your red cards, these are all your 2s. And when humans play this game, one thing that can be observed is that they use the same ideas or very similar ideas that they use in everyday conversation, just applied to this very restricted communication channel of giving hints to other players in these 2 different forms. Basically, to play the game, the players have to decide which card to play. The other player might give you a hint, and then you perform the same reasoning. Like, what's the goal this other person is trying to pursue with this hint? Well, if the other person tells me this card is red, they would only do that if the goal was for me to, I don't know, play this card or something like this. The game further restricts, you can only give limited number of hints. So it's really crucial for humans players to figure out how to use this communication in the most efficient manner possible to make the most use of the hints of the communicative actions they have available to them. It's a really interesting game. Google Brain DeepMind actually have called it a new frontier for AI research, because it really focuses on this cooperative aspect and this communicative aspect. And what I did was build AI agents that basically use crisis maxims to play Hanabi by using this intention, this concept of intentionality. By observing people, basically it's like, okay, why would you do a certain action if you get particular information in the game? Well, you reason about what goal is the other person trying to achieve. We can encode this goal-directed behavior into our agents. So basically our agents have, this is a list of viable goals in the game. Pick the one that is most appropriate and then figure out how you can convey not only that goal, but your plan to achieve that goal to the human player. And of course, because this communication is so limited, one of the key challenges in the game is if you give the wrong hint, if you provide the wrong information, it might be ambiguous because the other player doesn't see their own cards. If you tell them something, they might take it the wrong way. So you really must be careful about not making your information be interpretable in a different way. And this is basically a game that is based directly on crisis maxims. Each of the hints we can consider as a speech act, as a communicative action. We want each of these speech acts to serve a goal. And then the human player will try to deduce this goal. And our AI agents use exactly a parameterization of crisis maxims to predict how each of the hints is interpreted by the human player. Sorry. Excuse me. But to do that, we need one other piece. One of the challenges many times in communication is, and the reason for communication is that there's a disparity in knowledge between the parties that communicate. So in order to predict what the other player will do, the AI agent actually needs to model what the other player already knows or what the other player believes could be the case. And then we have a model that says each of the speech acts that is performed by this AI agent changes what the human player believes. And then we can use this new belief, this new updated belief, and match it against the list of potential goals and figure out which of those potential goals is a match for the updated player beliefs and what we predict, what we think the human player might do. And actually, like the agents that we built for this worked fairly well. I have one chart later with some scores, but it actually showed, like the work that we did actually showed that human players prefer communication in this way because it is closer to how they normally communicate. And really, when you think about it, Hanabi is a very Kreisian game. Well, maxim of quality is a bit out there because the game only allows you to tell the truth, so you couldn't even lie if you wanted to. But the other concepts, the maxim of quantity, because you have very limited number of hints, you don't want to tell the other player more than is necessary because that would be wasteful. But you also need to provide them as much information as they need to actually do what you want them to do or what should be done in the game. You only want to give hints if they're relevant to the game. Again, because it would be wasteful to just talk about things that are not immediately useful in service of a goal. And if you give a hint and it could serve multiple goals, it might be ambiguous and then the other player will do, well, maybe the wrong thing. So we also try to avoid that. And our agents implement exactly this behavior in order to play the game. So there are some challenges with that. And as I said, like I'm gonna talk about the challenges maybe even more than the actual approaches. One challenge is all of this assumes that humans are perfectly logical and have perfect memory, which is not true. One thing from direct observation is if you tell someone these are all your red cards, they know that the cards are red, but they also know that the others are not. But people don't usually take that into account or they forget it pretty quickly. They might misremember. If you tell them these cards are red, five rounds later, they're like, oh, which color was this? Because, you told me these cards were blue. And we don't have a good model of how forgetting, of how this discerning of information actually works. neither in the game nor in real life. Like there's some research on how's forgetting work, but it's not like we can tell you immediately what you're gonna remember and what you're gonna forget. But in order to improve this communication, we would need to figure that out. And as I mentioned earlier, I come from the classical AI side. This agent is basically classical AI planning agent with some epistemic logic behind it, etc. Why didn't I just use like machine learning to figure out what's the perfect strategy? Well, one problem with human behavior is there's no data. Well, for Hanabi, there was no, because it's a board game, there's no like game logs that we can scrape, that we can analyze of what do people usually do in these games, because well, that information was just not available. Even if it was available, it might be very difficult to discern general patterns. You need a lot of game logs. Well, after this work, we actually have several thousand game logs. This is like one of the next projects I want to tackle is look at the data that we have, which at this point is the largest collection of Hanabi data, but several thousand game logs is still not like huge amounts of information. But maybe we can use that to discern, at least for some situations, what would be a better move, what would be better action for the AI to take. And generally, like for human behavior, this is a real challenge. I will talk later about text generation. For that, it's easy to get data because all the internet is full of text. For actual behavior, it's a lot harder to get the necessary data to actually use a machine learning approach. And one of the ways to like jumpstart that is with classical AI approaches, with an explicit model of what we think the humans are gonna do. Okay. And this is fun because, well, it's a game, yay. But it's also not everything that humans do. Like, humans don't usually talk in the form of hints in a game. One important aspect of how humans communicate is non-verbal communication. And again, I will talk at the very end, I will talk about text generation, which is like one of the most common ways of communication or the one of the most studied ways of communication. But non-verbal communication is actually used by humans a lot and is very hard to understand by an AI agent and is not as commonly used in AI. But I think it would be important to incorporate that more into how our AI agents work. For example, timing of action can indicate information. Usually if people pause, they are thinking. And it's like, what am I gonna do? And this could mean two things. It could mean, well, if they're thinking for a long time, then that means the conclusion that they arrive at is more certain because they had more time to think. Or if they think more, it could be that the conclusion they arrive at is less certain because they had more options to consider and they don't actually know which one is the right one. So just using timing is already like hard to figure out what to do with that information. What's more, maybe more direct and more directly linked to what I was talking about before, there have been studies that basically say that where a person is looking indicates what their future plans are, what their intentions are, what their goals might be. So by actually, there's like cheap eye tracking devices that work reasonably well, there's more expensive ones that have more resolution, but it's not impossible to track a user's gaze on a screen to figure out what might their plans be. And then our AI agents that are trying to communicate, they're trying to figure out what the human is trying to tell them, can use that extra information to discern the human player's goals. Facial expressions are very commonly used to convey emotions. And again, emotions can give you information. If a person looks frustrated, well, they might be unhappy with the situation. If a person looks happy, maybe the AI agent knows that it's giving the right responses and it has figured out the goal that the human is trying to pursue. And all of these things, and there's a lot more, like I'm not even talking about like hand movement and so on, which is even harder to like figure out by an AI agent. All of this can be used to aid with this human communication and how to understand what the human is trying to convey. We did some preliminary work and some experiments, for example, this is like the diagram, like the graph I promised earlier. we did build a version of our AI agent that took timing into account. In Hanabi, higher scores are better. And like you can see a little bit that this cyan bars, which are like the agent that took timing into account, sometimes has a slightly higher score than the other agent, which is literally exactly the same agent without the timing information. And this orangey red one. And this already shows one of the problems. It's like, yeah, sure, the cyan one had a better performance, there's a statistical significant difference, but it's not like as clear. It's not like we can just take timing and deduce everything from that. It's a very subtle behavior. It comes up a few percent of the cases only. So it's really hard to actually make use of this information, but it is possible. And I think one of the key insights here is we can use it, but it's always only gonna be in addition to other things. And if it's worth to go this extra length, to go into this extra trouble or not, depends a lot on the application area. Similarly, we have looked at, this is actually an implementation of Hanabi that a student did, where she integrated an eye tracker into a Hanabi agent. And then we did some preliminary analysis of where people are looking during the game. And you can see like, oh, there's like an accumulation of a look of gaze on certain cards, and there's like less on other cards. Again, this is not something we can just use as it is and be done with it. We need to integrate it with other communication means. And this project, one of the next steps we still want to do, we haven't done yet, is figure out how to actually integrate this information with the AI agent. The paper I was talking about before with the timing, which was published in July. So this is one of the next steps that we want to take. And now we know that these things convey information, but we don't actually know exactly how to use it. As I said, in some situations, longer thinking time means uncertainty, more uncertainty. In other situations, it means less uncertainty. It means higher certainty. And figuring out which is still an open problem. In Hanabi, we've discovered higher thinking times usually mean more uncertainty because players need to figure out what to tell the AI agent that the AI agent can interpret reasonably, because there are too many competing options and each of them is less than optimal. Gaze again can communicate intentions, but we still need to integrate that with our AI agents. Okay, so this was explicit communication. Even gaze, even like facial expressions, I would call explicit communication because there's some form of conveying of information going on. And I know it's like a bit of a gray area if it's explicit or not. But now I'm going to talk about just briefly one problem of there's no communication at all, like explicit communication. The only thing the AI agent knows is what the human player is doing. Like human player, human user is doing in the game, the actions they are performing. And this is actually a pretty common scenario. Think about a user on the computer trying to do something. Well, they oftentimes or usually don't tell the computer, now I'm trying to open the settings menu to change the resolution of the screen or something. They're just clicking around wildly in different menus, trying to figure out where on earth is the setting to change the screen resolution. And a smart AI assistant could look at these actions and try to discern, try to figure out what the human is actually trying to achieve. For that, we used a different game. And I promise we started this work last year. The game is like 12 years old, but it is called Pandemic and it's about players trying to fight disease outbreaks around the world. And basically the idea is the game is cooperative. There are multiple players. They have to walk around the game board and remove these disease cubes, and they have to find cures for the diseases. And there's like a certain, the two goals are a bit at odds with one another, because in order to cure the diseases, the players need to spread out in order to not cure, to heal the diseases, they need to spread out because they actually need to go to each city to remove the disease cubes. In order to find the cures, they need to get together into the same location because they need to share some of their cards, etc. And one thing we did, this is actually the implementation of the game by one of my students. What we did is we said there's no communication whatsoever inside the game. Of course, when people play that, they will talk, but our AI agent is playing with a human player without any explicit communication, just by observing what the human player is doing inside the game, observing the actions, and then trying to figure out why the human player is performing these actions. And basically, trying to figure out what is the human player trying to achieve? How can I, as the AI agent, contribute to this goal? And basically, my master student, Pablo Sauma, is about to finish his thesis about AI agents that use a method of goal recognition to collaborate with humans in this game. Same problem as before, there was no data. Like, we couldn't just go and say like, okay, we'll use machine learning to figure out what human players are trying to do in this game, because we didn't have this information. So we built, or better, my student built an explicit model of plan recognition, of goal recognition, to figure out what the human player is trying to achieve, and then a separate process that plans what the AI agent is supposed to do to help with that goal. And again, I think this is a very interesting problem because it comes up in many different scenarios, not just in the game, but in the game we can say like, well, now we've been like 30%, 34% of the games with the human player, which is actually pretty good, I would say. But one of the problems that we figured out is this whole process is based on the idea that what the human player is doing is optimal. Humans are not perfectly logical, perfectly rational beings. They do not have infinite computation capabilities. Well, they have very limited computation capabilities. So they might not figure out the optimal move. And if the AI player assumes whatever the human does is the optimal move to reach a goal, we have a problem. So we did get to a very decent performance, but we think there's a lot of room for improvement by figuring out when do human players like miss reason about what they're trying to do, what they should be doing to achieve a particular goal. And this is, again, still an open problem, still a challenge for us. But as I said, I think this is very applicable to many different domains. Okay, finally, I talked about like hint giving in Hanabi, I talked about nonverbal communication, I talked about implicit communication, but really one of the most common ways, the most common way to communicate is using language. And there's like different aspects. One is like voice recognition or speech recognition. One of them is text recognition, etc. I'm gonna just focus on something that's been on the AI news for a while now, which is language models, which are like these things that are basically autocompletes where you start a sentence and then they can continue the sentence, particular like GPT-2, GPT-3. And they're based on neural networks that basically use an encoding of sentences of written text into some neural network architecture. And then they can either predict, you have a sentence, you say like this word is missing, this word is missing, this word is missing. They predict the words that are missing in the sentence. That's called the mask language model. BERT is like one of the most famous ones of those. Or a causal language model, which basically says we have the start of a sentence and then we try to predict what are the next words. And so we can start writing something. And especially GPT-2, GPT-3 have received a lot of attention, like a lot of attention, because they're scary good. And I'm actually, I should preface this section with, I'm gonna show you a lot of things that can go wrong, but please do not misunderstand. These two networks and others are amazing. They can produce text that is very, very good a lot of the time. But they have very specific failure cases that are problematic. And as I said, I'm not fun at parties. I'm going to focus on the failure cases. But these things are great. And I've been working with those as part of a consulting job, and they produce interesting, like very, very interesting, very appropriate output in many scenarios. It's mostly a matter of feeding them the right inputs to produce the output that you need. Because if you feed them the wrong input, bad things happen. So what are they? GPT-2, GPT-3, this GPT stands for Generative Pre-trained Transformer. Basically, like, it can generate text. How does it do that? You say, like, we have a sentence. What's the next word? Then you add that to your sentence. What's the next word? Then you add that, and so on. So you can produce as much text as you want. It's pre-trained. OpenAI, the organization that released those, actually gives you weights for the neural networks that are pre-trained on existing data. And the transformers, which is like this attention-based neural network architecture that they use. Okay, GPT-2 was trained on text from Reddit. That's like one of these internet things. And GPT-3 was trained on Common Core data, which is like a net internet scraping service that collects data from a lot of different things. So what's the problem with that? Well, the obvious problem is it's very biased data, right? It's like from Reddit, it's from the internet. So it contains a lot of different things. The other problem is, and you all are more familiar with that than me, is it's a lot of data. Reddit is huge, well, Common Core, all the internet. Yeah, so you need very powerful hardware to actually do any training on these things. But again, the bias of the data is problematic. So for example, I asked GPT-2, the man is, that's the prefix I gave it. And then it continued with the former soldier who was a member of the British Army's Elite Special Forces Unit, the SAS. Okay. And then I tried the same thing for the woman is, and then the woman is a former teacher at the school and the mother of three, I'm very sorry for the pain, et cetera, et cetera. So it has clearly very different roles, very different models of the two genders, of these two genders. And it produces text that is, well, this is actually one of the less bad outputs that it produces in certain scenarios. Again, it's all about what you feed it as input. I just said, like, tell me what you think a man is. And well, of course, it's Reddit, so we would say this happens. It's not much better if you ask GPT-3. It basically says the man is still standing there, blah, 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 and he's pointing a gun at you. So again, it has a very particular model of what a man is. It's like violent, it's pointing a gun, et cetera. On the other hand, the woman is a little older than you, face is still young. She wears a simple dress that shows off most of her curves. So it focuses on very different things when you ask it about women than when you ask it about men. And of course, that's inherent in the data. Could be an excuse you could make, but it's not helping, right? We're just reinforcing the stereotypes by just using the data as it is. So that's one problem we have with this. Another problem is people are like, this is gonna replace writers. Sam Altman actually said the GPT-3 hype is way too much. It's impressive, and it is, I agree, but it still has serious weaknesses and sometimes makes very silly mistakes. Who is Sam Altman? He's actually the CEO of OpenAI. So even the CEO of the company that made it says, this is too much. And again, I think these things produce amazing output much of the time, but they do have serious problems. So it's not just we're gonna replace all writers when OpenAI releases GPT-3 to the public in a couple of months, we're not just gonna replace all writers that exist. There's a different application. That's basically you give, this is a combination of image recognition and language models where you give the bot, this chatbot, a picture, and then you can ask it questions about the picture. First, it will give it a picture, those are my cats. I gave it this picture and it said like, this is a couple of cats laying on the couch. Almost correct, it's a bat, but I guess that's hard for humans to distinguish, so awesome. So then you can ask it questions about the picture. What did I ask it? How many giraffes are in this picture? And so there's one. And I checked, I couldn't find any giraffes anywhere in my apartment. And I was like, well, how about how many pink elephants are in this picture? And it says two. And this brings us back to something I talked about before. why would it say that? Why would it make such an outrageous claim that there's a giraffe in this picture? Like, it has no reason to believe that. Like, maybe Mona has like a little bit of orange, but she looks nothing like a giraffe. Of course, how are these models trained? By human-provided input data. How do humans talk? Well, remember Grisius-Maximov relation? You only cannot talk about that's relevant to the topic of discussion. So if you see a picture of two cats, you're not gonna say there are no giraffes in this picture. That's not something a human will usually do. So if you just have images and text descriptions, it will never say there's no giraffe. So the AI agent has no concept, this machine learning model has no concept of what it means for an image to have nothing of a particular object, because it's not in its training data. Only when there are giraffes, the human will say like there's a giraffe, or there's five giraffes, or there's two pink elephants. So the language model basically does not know about this communication theory. It doesn't know that you're only telling it what's relevant. And it also doesn't know when I asked it how many giraffes are in this picture. It can't figure out that, why would I do that? Like, do I actually want to know if they're giraffes, or do I just want to get a number? In its model of the world, I asked it how many giraffes are there. It will look up, very simplified, in its training data, how many giraffes are typical in pictures, and then give me the closest one to the picture I gave it. And it says, well, one. And it's not like intelligent. It has no sense of reality. It has no sense of, and maybe it's my fault because I violated this cooperative principle. I'm trying to trick it. But it has no sense of what's true, what can be true, and what not. It wouldn't make any sense for a giraffe to be in a picture of two cats laying on a couch. It should just say, like, this makes no sense. But that's not an answer it has. And for GPT-3, you can do the same thing. I just made up words. It's like, how many Blosseri are in an oak? I can't even pronounce my own words, Okbolisa. And it taught me something. It told me, like, there are about as many as there are people. Because it doesn't know, it doesn't assume that, like, what would a human do in this situation? It's like, I don't know what these words mean, or you're just making up words here. The model does not have any concept of this kind of communication. So that is still a big challenge. Actually using how humans communicate, this whole communication theory that I talked about at the beginning, and how we can apply that to these generated outputs, to these intelligent chatbots. How can we make them say, I don't know? So in conclusion, I think I'm almost out of time. So perfect. Basically, like, using this communication theory, we can build AI agents that play games relatively well with human players. We've already done that. It's still tricky to integrate this nonverbal communication, and getting data for actual human behavior is challenging. Maybe there are existing games. Well, there are existing games that we can exploit, especially video games have lots of data available that we might be able to use for more data-driven approaches. We use a belief model for communication. I'm gonna skip this slide just for time because I want to talk about, well, I talk a lot about games, but really all the things I talk about have a lot of other applications. Intelligent tutoring systems are maybe the closest. It's like teaching a student, the student gets stuck and asks, like, how do I continue? Like, I want to do this mathematical proof as a student, and I get stuck, and it's like, how do I continue? The same mechanisms that we use in Hanabi to, like, give small hints to figure out what is the player, what's the student in this case trying to do, and what we should tell them to do next could be applied to these scenarios. Professional training, similar idea. Like, you have a firefighter in a training scenario, they need to do something, maybe they get stuck, maybe, well, they're a trainee, they don't know exactly what to do. There's like some AI-based instructor that can tell them, oh, you're currently trying to achieve this. Here's the next step that you should take. I started with Alexa, of course. Like, better Alexa, better smart assistants is one of the other applications for this kind of work. And yeah, the language models, they're very powerful. They produce very cool outputs many times, but they're not a complete solution. So we still need to figure out how to actually make them communicate more like a human. Okay, well, thank you so much. If you want to reach out, my email address is emigratecpp.edu. can follow me on Twitter. You can also find the slides for this talk on slothlab.info/Carla. So you can actually get, well, all the links, my Twitter and all of these things there. Thank you very much. And I think we have some time for questions.
Yes, thank you very much, Marcus. We do have a few questions. Let me read them to you one by one. You mentioned in your talk that what you are basically looking at in your cooperative AI agents is to decide what would be the better move at any moment, right? What about using reinforcement learning to improve the agent's performance?
Yes, so there are approaches there. As I said, one of the challenges is, like, you can do a hybrid approach. You can do like reinforcement learning to train your agent, maybe on offline data, maybe with itself. But one of the problems, and this happens a lot in reinforcement learning, is the agent finds some exploitative strategy that humans won't understand. Particularly for Hanabi, there is a lot of people that, actually there's a lot of Hanabi research going on. There is an approach by DeepMind that actually uses a combination of approaches that learns a communication strategy by a reinforcement learning approach. But the problem is the communication strategy that comes out is completely ununderstandable for humans, because it starts encoding crazy things into the communicative actions. I can see a hybrid approach. The problem really is you cannot feasibly run reinforcement learning just with human players, because you would need like thousands of games, but maybe you can pre-train it a little bit, make sure it doesn't go into one of these exploitative niches, and then use that as a basis for like human play, and then improve it from there. It's possible, but it's not as straightforward as you might think. Yeah, thank you for your question, though.
Thank you. The next question we get from the audience is, in the last few years, we have seen an explosion in the diversity of architectures. Mm-hmm. How can your cooperative AI agents benefit from these diverse architectures?
Again, I think that I think the main bottleneck were not the architectures. In my case, the main bottleneck is really the input data. So I think, especially like recent research in like few shot and zero shot learning has a lot of potential, and there are like very interesting approaches there. I actually talked to a colleague at UC Davis about Hanabi training from like few replays. Like they've been working on, I think they're still working on how to actually learn Hanabi strategies, not from a lot of data, but from little data. And that would be an interesting approach. I really don't think the architectures are the problem there. It's really the data that's the problem. And getting to these things that can learn from less information is, I think, the most promising avenue.
Okay, thank you. Okay, our next question is, what do you think are the practical limitations of the languages that you are currently using to develop your cooperative AI agent models?
That's a very interesting question, because I've actually used, I've used Python, I've used Haskell, I've used Python, Haskell, C Sharp. I've used like a lot of different things for different aspects of the agents, because one of the challenges really is, depending on what you want to model, like belief models can get very big. You don't want to explicitly model everything. Haskell lazy evaluation was actually really, really cool, really useful for modeling beliefs to arbitrary levels of nesting. I didn't talk about that, but beliefs about beliefs about beliefs, etc. I don't think there's like a clear limitation of the language that I'm using, because I'm trying to use whatever is most appropriate, but I've run into problems with, well, Python for machine learning for memory reasons, but I think that's more like a different issue. not like an actual Python issue. It's more like a these things need a lot of memory issue.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, thank you.
We still have two more questions.
Okay.
The next one is, how complex or difficult is it for an AI agent to grasp context during an interaction with human collaborator? because I have read a little bit about Hanabi, and I think one of the approaches that researchers are intending to use is theory of mind, so the ability to form, to understand another agent as an agent with a model, right? With a mental model.
Yeah, that's basically what I'm doing. Like my agents have a model of what the other player believes, and that is important. I think context is very different from different applications. In Hanabi, there's not a lot of context. There's still things that the AI agents leave out, especially like human players take into account the order in which cards were drawn. Like if I just drew a card, I will treat it differently than a card that I drew 3 rounds ago, because like recency has some sort of meaning to humans. So that is additional context that the AI agents only partially take into account. In other scenarios, I think like the more complex or the more open your domain gets, the more context you have, and that actually becomes very challenging. And I think one of the problems with, or one of the challenges in a Turing test is exactly that. It's like, there's a lot of context. There's a lot of cultural context. If I asked a bot about Lady Gaga, well, maybe it knows it because it was in its training data. But if it was like something that happened last week, the MTV Music Awards video, whatever they're called, sorry. It might not know that because it was trained like 2 months ago. And I think that kind of context is very relevant and challenging.
Thank you. And the last question is, do you think it is possible to know or estimate previous to execution the performance in computing costs of your cooperative agents? Communications, there's a comment here. Communication algorithms are traditionally high cost.
So yes and no. This is, again, this depends on the application. For the Hanabi agents, for example, because they are like coded by observation. So this is like a direct model of how I observed human communication to work. I can tell you pretty exactly how long this will take because it's a very fixed algorithm that looks at like several pieces of information, but it's not hard to predict how long this will take. For other things, for Pandemic, we have a real challenge there. We actually don't know how long it will take. We just we use a anytime algorithm. So we basically tell it just stop after, I don't know, 200 milliseconds so that you don't take too long for your turn. And this is challenging. So it really depends on the application and the implementation of like the different approaches.
I see. Well, thank you very much for your participation. Your talk was really interesting, and I think this raises questions for our community beyond what we have seen in this conference. So we really thank you for your contribution.
Thank you very much for having me. It was very exciting to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye, Marcus.
Bye.
Thank you very much, Alvaro, for this excellent session. So now for me, it's a pleasure to present Dr. Gerardo Cisneros Sobianowski from HPC AI Advisory Council. Gerardo Cisneros Sobianowski is a member of the Mexican Academy of Science and the American Physics Society and a life senior member of the IEEE Computer Society. He was research professor at the EPN and research professor at the Institute of Science of the Autonomous University of Puebla in Mexico. Later, he held application thesis, principal system engineer, and member of the technical staff position to serve an SGI. He listed as contributor of the NWHM Computer Chip Mr. Application. Gerardo Cisneros Sobianowski is author of more than 40 papers on application of computing to solid state physics and quantum chemistry, and a programming language for symbolic manipulation. He holds his bachelor's degrees in physics and mathematics in communication and electronic engineering from the National Polytechnic Institute, IPN, in Mexico, as well as master's degrees in electrical engineering and his PhD degree in electrical engineering and computer science from Princeton University. Gerardo is one of the most interested people to perform the HPC NI community here in Latin America. And for us, it's a pleasure to have here the present in Carla 2020. Please, Gerardo, and welcome to Carla 2020.
Thank you. Muchas gracias. I thought my bio was gonna be read in Spanish and people could go read it in English on the website, but it doesn't matter. Thank you very much. So most people know that I work for Mellanox now in video networking, but one of my job responsibilities is also to collaborate with the HPC AI Advisory Council. And so I am speaking on their behalf today, on the council's behalf today. So what is the HPC AI Advisory Council? Well, it's a nonprofit organization of more than 400 member companies, universities, government and private research centers, labs, etc. And the idea is to promote the good use of HPC and artificial intelligence. It has a support and development center. We have a cluster center that I'll show you in a minute, and best practices for it. And the idea is to explore future technologies and developments. So I'll just skip to the next slide. So this is more or less, this is the 400 logo slide. This is these are pretty much all of the members that support that are a part of the High Performance Computing and Artificial Intelligence Advisory Council. And this is just a sample of what we have in the cluster center. These machines are actually accessible to the general public, to people interested in HPC, to testing stuff, and it's free of charge. Okay, and I'll post the link, the URL to the chat window at the end of the talk. But right now we have three 32 node clusters, two of them with Skylake processors, one with Broadwell processors. We have an 8 node Epic Rome cluster. We have a Power 8 cluster and a few other smaller systems. All of them have InfiniBand, the either HDR 100 or HDR. And for example, the Broadwell cluster has two fabrics, one in a FAT3 configuration and another single switch one, so one can do comparisons of between the different fabric topologies, even at that small scale. So from our point of view, without a network, there wouldn't be any high performance computing or HPC artificial intelligence, because that's the glue that brings everything together. A bunch, I've said it before and I'll say it again, a bunch of servers isn't a supercomputer, isn't a parallel supercomputer until it has a high-speed network connecting the servers that allows a single application to efficiently use all of the servers towards obtaining the solution of a problem. So networks have evolved Well, at least the InfiniBand network has evolved from just being a message or packet shuffler among hosts and storage and whatnot, to having itself some computational intelligence. And so the fabric now, the switches and the host communications adapters, the HCAs, now have some computational powers and allow applications to exploit what we call in-network computing, which Scott Schultz talked about a couple hours ago, or an hour and a half ago. So he already talked about this, Sharp. This is one feature of the in-network computing capability of the InfiniBand fabric. It embodies a tree-based aggregation mechanism whereby the switches collect data from the hosts, pass it on to the next level, and then everything is aggregated at this top level, and then it trickles back down to the HCAs and to the CPUs. It implements essentially reduction. Apart from barriers, it implements reduce and broadcast collective operations in MPI, and the equivalents in the Shamam library with the various operations that can be used with these collective MPI operations. And it may operate on integer and floating point operands. So the question has come up before: are you telling me that the switches have computational capability to do floating point operation? Yes. The answer is definitely yes. This slide, I think Scott had this or another version of this slide. The idea of Sharp is to reduce the time it takes to complete these collective operations. And so in the left panels, the broken lines are the time it takes to do these operations in software, and the solid lines are the time it takes to do them in hardware in the fabric with Sharp. So there is a substantial reduction in the latency that these operations take. This has been tried all the way up to 1500 nodes, either using one process per node or using 40, all 40 processes per node in this particular machine, which is Niagara. Currently, I think still the fastest supercomputing in Canada. It's 1500 nodes of Skylakes with 40 cores per node. So this is the time it takes. So the gray bars are the time it takes the MPI to do an all reduce in software, and the little green bars are what the time it takes that to do it with support from the fabric hardware, from the switches and the HCAs. The other MPI feature that can be offloaded to the fabric is tag matching, hardware tag matching. And this is required, tag matching is required by point-to-point communications. MPI sends and MPI receives carry with the, attach to every message a tag that must be matched at the receiving side. So what happens here, this is the software side, and from on this side of the dot of this dashed lines is the HCA. The HCA keeps, as messages arrive, it keeps a matching list And if the message arrived while not having been expected, then it will have to be handled in software. However, if there is a matching tag to the message that just arrived, then the message was expected. So now we have to ask about the protocol for this message. Is it rendezvous or is it eager? Rendezvous is used for large messages. And what happens is that the hardware does not send very large messages uncalled for. So if the answer to rendezvous is yes, what will happen is without participation from the host CPU, it will gather the remote data and put it into the applications buffer. If it's not, then the message arrived with the data and it will just scatter the data to the local buffer as called for by the corresponding MPI receive. So how does this help the software? So these are latency measurements on point-to-point communications at various message sizes, and done with MVAPage 2 alone, which would be the software solution only, and those are the gray curves, and MVAPage 2 plus hardware tag matching. These were provided by Ohio State, where MVAPage is developed. So lower is better, and you can see that almost a twofold reduction in latency can be obtained by enabling hardware tag matching. That is, letting the InfiniBand fabric do the tag matching for you, for the library. This slide was also in Scott's presentation. So as he said, we can distinguish two types of congestion in an interconnection fabric. In network congestion is when everybody's talking to everybody else. And the solution to reduce that kind of congestion is called adaptive routing. On the right-hand side of the slide, we have in-cast congestion in which many processes are banging on a single receiving process, and how we alleviate that is with congestion control. I'm not going to talk about congestion control in the remaining slides. I'm going to show you a couple applications where adaptive routing makes a difference. So in adaptive routing, InfiniBand defines a variety of routing algorithms that can be configured by the subnet manager. There's this process running on the fabric that defines how things are done in it. So it is actually a capability of the switches that allows those switches to select the best and least busy routes for each network packing crossing the network. And so so that selection allows it to spread the traffic and avoid point congestions. So as I said earlier, the last few slides are going to review examples of application performance improvement when InfiniBand adaptive routing is used. So the first example is called VSM Bench. It's an open source HPC benchmarking tool that's derived from simulation code from lattice gauge theory of particle physics, and BSM stands for Beyond the Standard Model. One interesting feature of this benchmark is that it allows the user to tune the ratio of communications and computation, and it comes with three ready tuned examples, one in which the problem is dominated by computation. I just noticed that the labels here are backwards. There's another one where communications dominate and one where those two are balanced. And as I mentioned, the application is to lattice quantum chromodynamics model of particle physics. And that particular application of high-performance computing consumes a significant fraction of computing cycles around the world. So if we run the balance benchmark from 8 to 128 nodes without adaptive routing, we get a certain performance. And if we enable adaptive routing, the switches start working with us, and we can get up to 28% better performance at the high end, at the largest number of nodes. How about the computationally intensive benchmark? Fewer communication, you still get about 14% better performance with adaptive routing than without at 128 nodes. And finally, if for this example, if we apply it to the communications benchmark, 16%. So noticeable improvement when one applies adaptive routing. Moving on to the next example, which is from computational quantum chemistry, we're gonna look at the Vienna ab initio simulation package, better known as VASP, which is essentially an electronic atomic and molecular structure calculation program that it also includes molecular dynamics. Okay, so what it does for the example that we're going to show, it computes an approximate solution to the many-body Schrödinger equation using density functional theory and hybrid functionals to mix both Hartree-Fock and DFT. Okay. So this is just a big benchmarking example called gallium arsenide bismuth 512. This simulates a piece of the semiconductor gallium arsenide that has been doped with bismuth atoms. And there are 512 atoms altogether. And so there are a lot of electrons flying around that have to be modeled by the program. And there's a lot of communications in this particular benchmark. And when you include adaptive routing, when you enable adaptive routing in the switches, you also get an appreciable improvement in performance. So these are two examples of the stuff that that is studied at the with the resources of the HPC Advisory HPC AI Advisory Council. I forgot that AI was added recently, but we have done a bunch of best practices. Analysis of lots of applications. A few of them are fairly old. We are a little shorthanded, but we are continuing to update all of these. Now, to wrap up, a few words about what the HPCA Advisory Council does, in addition to what I just described, is apart from the best practices for the applications and the cluster center that I talked about, the HPC AI Council sponsors several conferences, five per year, in Stanford, Australia, which was earlier this week. There's one in China coming up at the end of the month. There's one in the United Kingdom in October, and another one in China in November. And these are yearly events. Some of these started recently, and others have been going on for more than 10 years. The council also sponsors student cluster competitions, the HPC AI student cluster competition. The one that is ongoing at this time is the APAC HPC AI competition. It started in March, and we let the students work on it for several weeks or months. Then there's one that is more one of the more famous ones, the one that goes on in Germany at the International Supercomputing Conference. And of course, it's the competition is sponsored by both the council and the ISC organizers, and that happens in June. This year, it was it went virtual. And then in July, there was an APAC-specific competition for RDMA programming. So I'll post URLs and my email addresses in a minute in the chat. But with that, I will thank you for your attention and be open to questions. I have 5 minutes.
Of course, Cisneros. Yeah. In fact, there are some questions for the audience here, for the audience in the YouTube channel. So the first one, let's say, thank you very much for your intervention, Dr. Gerardo from Puebla. We have important concerns in bandwidth when we implement simulation codes. The solution for your experience is from the size of the fabricants or from the people that makes MPI codes?
Say again, they had what kind of problem?
Yes, they say, we have important concerns in bandwidth when we implement simulation codes. The solution for your experience is from the size of the fabricants or from the people that make MPI codes.
Well, the thing is, there are several versions of MPI. And the idea is that you have to use an MPI version that is properly tuned to exploit the fabric as optimally. Okay, for InfiniBand, I would say that our own HPC, well, NVIDIA's Mellanox's HPCX, which is based on OpenMPI, Intel's MPI and MBAPH are all tuned with to exploit the capabilities of the InfiniBand fabric.
Okay, thank you. The second one is about the MPI is for better the best way to perform scientific application. What about the use of MPI for artificial intelligence in large scale platform?
I'm gonna pass on that because artificial intelligence is not my field of expertise, and it's not my cup of tea either. That would have been a better question for Scott when he talked. Sorry about that. I'm gonna have to disappoint you on that.
Okay, no problem. Yes. Okay. The other one. Specialized people say that InfiniBand is in the end of the days, and it's important to propose another way to make communication. Is this true?
I didn't really catch that. Please, again.
Yes, I think that it say that the InfiniBand is in the end of the use in HPC. So what do you think if it is necessary to propose another way to make communication?
That is not correct. InfiniBand has a roadmap that is nowhere near ending. there is some competition, but over the years, InfiniBand has buried a series of previous competing fabrics, the last of which was OmniPath architecture, which Intel decided to discontinue. InfiniBand is still going strong. NVIDIA has no intention of shutting down its networking division. It acquired the networking division when it bought Mellanox. Yeah, okay. That's not gonna happen anytime soon.
Okay, the other question, it's more a general question. There are a chapter of HPC, AI Council in Latin America?
Not that I know of, but the idea is to approach the council and become members, and then the man who would have the last word about that would be Gilad Shiner, who's my supervisor, or boss's boss, however you want to see it.
Okay, and we have another final question here that, for your experience, what is the next challenge for networks in HPC?
Oh, no, the challenge has always been the lower the latency and increase the bandwidth. That is the challenge, and increase the bandwidth is the next step in InfiniBand. The next generation of InfiniBand, called NDR, will be twice as fast as HDR. Now, latency, that's a more difficult proposition because it's limited by the speed of light, of how fast signals can traverse a given distance. On cables or on optical fiber or whatever. So latency here is a limiting factor, but bandwidth is nowhere near ending. Bandwidth increase is nowhere near yet ending.
Okay, so thank you very much, Dr. Gerardo.
No, thank you for having me.
With you present here in CALA 2020. Okay. So thank you very much. So for the rest, in 1 hour, we start with the afternoon program. So in the same link, see you in 1 hour. Thank you very much.